Good morning and welcome to the fifth meeting of the Education and Culture Committee in 2016. Can I remind everybody to make sure that all electronic devices are switched off at all times. Our first item is to consider the Higher Education Governance Scotland Bill at Stage 2. Can I welcome the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Lifelong Learning and her officials? Good morning and welcome to the committee. Can I welcome Tavi Scott, who's substituting for Liam MacArthur this morning? And can I also welcome to the committee Jimmy D, Ian Gray, Liz Smith and Sandra White, who are also attending for this item of business. Everyone should have with them a copy of the bill as introduced, the marshalled list of amendments and the groupings of amendments. For each debate, I will call the member who lodged the first amendment in that group to speak to and move that amendment and to speak to all other amendments in the group. All other members with amendments in the group, including the Cabinet Secretary, are relevant, will then be asked to speak to them. Members who have not lodged amendments in the group but who wish to speak should indicate that by catching the attention of either myself or the clerks. If the Cabinet Secretary has not already spoken in the group, I will invite the Cabinet Secretary to contribute to the debate just before moving to the wind-up speeches. Speech. The debate on the group will be concluded by me inviting the member who moved the first amendment in the group to wind up. Following debate on each group, I will check whether the member who moved the first amendment in the group wishes to press it to a vote or to withdraw it. And if they wish to press ahead, I will put that question on that amendment. If a member wishes to withdraw their amendment after it has been moved, they must seek approval to do so. If any member objects, the committee immediately moves to the vote on the amendment. If any member does not want to move their amendment when called, they should say not moved. Please note that, of course, that any other MSP may move such an amendment. If no one moves the amendment, I will immediately call the next amendment on the marshalled list. Only committee members, of course, are allowed to vote. Voting in any division is by a show of hands. It's important that members please keep their hands clearly raised until the clerk has recorded the vote. The committee is required to indicate formally that it has considered and agreed each section of the bill, and so I'll also put a question on each section at the appropriate point. And as I said before we started, we intend to go through all the amendments today. So with that, can I call Amendment 3 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, group with Amendments 4, 4A, 4B, 21, 24, 25 and 26. Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 3 and to speak to all amendments in the group. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, committee and colleagues. In considering this and indeed all the groupings of amendments, it is important to bear in mind the purpose of this legislation. Essentially, this government aims to ensure that every voice in the higher education community is heard and that through this modest and focused bill, we can enable an approach to governance based on greater transparency and inclusivity, which supports continuous improvement in the operation of our higher education institutions. Providing for the election of a senior lay member on the governing body of each Scottish HE institution is key to this ambition, and these amendments set out this new role and also how it would interact with the statutory role of rectors where that role exists. As promised at stage one, these amendments seek to make provision on the face of the bill in place of the original regulation making power in section one for the establishment of an elected chairing member. Throughout stage one, we listened to the views of stakeholders and the committee. In particular, I considered very carefully the views of rectors and their supporters. This has informed development of the wider provisions set out, chiefly in amendments 3 to 10. To avoid impinging on the statutory role of rectors and to respect their valued contribution to our institutions, the elected position provided for in our amendments is that the senior lay member of the governing body of all Scottish higher education institutions. With reference to this role, the Scottish Code of Good HE Governance separates it from the role of rector by talking about it as an extensive role of chair, variously called senior governor, vice convener or convener. So there can be no ambiguity about the pivotal role played by the senior lay member in each higher education institution. Turning to Amendment 3, these provisions oblige each Scottish higher education institution to feature the position of senior lay member on its governing body and specify his or her core functions. These functions include a duty to preside at meetings of the governing body, a deliberative and casting vote at such meetings, and responsibility for the leadership and effectiveness of the governing body, as well as ensuring that there is an appropriate balance of authority between the governing body and the principal principle, a term whose ordinary meaning is understood to encompass other designations used in certain HEIs, such as director. Subsection 3 enables higher education institutions to select another member of the governing body to perform those functions when the position of senior lay member is vacant or the holder is unable to attend a meeting. Crucially, subsection 4 in Amendment 3 makes it clear that the functions of the senior lay member are subject to the provisions of Amendment 4. Subsections 1 and 2 of Amendment 4 ensure that in relation to the ancient universities, the historical role of rector provided for in statute is protected. Mr Maxwell's Amendment 4A would dilute the statutory protection in subsections 1 and 2 and effectively allow for the removal of the statutory rights of rectors by higher education institutions' governing bodies. I do not think that is an outcome that any of us would wish to see, and I would hope therefore that Mr Maxwell does not press his Amendment 4A. Amendment 4, as lodged in my name on 2nd of February, also enables the governing bodies of universities with a rector to allow the rector to make some of the role described for the senior lay members in Amendment 3. This is what subsections 3 and 4 allow, but only where a governing body wishes to do so. And I must make it clear that these subsections do not affect the statutory protection of the role of rector in the ancient universities under subsections 1 and 2 of Amendment 4. The power at subsections 3 and 4 was intended to recognise the autonomy of universities and would give them maximum flexibility within the governance requirements of this bill. However, having considered Mr Maxwell's Amendment 4B effectively removing subsections 3 and 4 in my Amendment 4, I am content to encourage the committee to support it as achieving the core intentions of Amendment 4. Amendment 4B seeks to protect the statutory role of rectors at the ancient universities and goes no further than that. There is, on balance, an advantage in these provisions remaining focused on the core intention of protecting the statutory role of rectors. Turning briefly to the remaining amendments in this group, Amendment 21 removes Section 14 of the Bill as the regulation-making powers contained in Sections 1, 2, 8 and 13 of the Bill at introduction are now subject to other government amendments removing them, so Section 14 will not be required. I am mindful that many of our HE institutions perceive the extent of regulation-making powers in the Bill as having a detrimental impact on their autonomy. I hope this, and indeed other amendments laid at this stage, remove all concerns in that regard. Amendment 24 ensures restoration of the statutory role of rector under Section 4 of the University of Scotland Act 1858. This Act applies to the ancient universities of Glasgow, Edinburgh, St Andrews and Aberdeen and provides that the rector is the ordinary president of the court with a deliberative and a casting vote. I felt it was necessary to remove this provision at introduction when Section 1 of the Bill proposed that regulations would make provision for the appointment of a chairing member. However, Amendments 3 to 10 and Amendment 12 proposed to replace that regulation making power with full provision on the face of the Bill, which protects the statutory role of rectors, so it would therefore be appropriate to ensure Section 4 of the 1858 Act continues. Likewise, Amendment 25 ensures restoration of the statutory role of rector under Section 5 of the University of Scotland Act 1889, which applies to the ancient universities of Glasgow, Edinburgh, St Andrews and Aberdeen and provides that the rector has the right to preside at meetings of the court and has a deliberative and casting vote. Crucially, Amendment 25 also provides that the senior lay member should preside at meetings of the relevant governing body or court when the rector cannot attend or preside. Legislation from 1889 sets out that in the absence of the rector in an ancient institution, a vice-chancellor elected by the governing body can preside. As the new senior lay member would be an elected post, it is our view that the new senior lay member should preside when the rector is unable to do so. Lastly, convener, Amendment 26 is consequential on Amendment 25, seeking to amend paragraph 2.2d of this bill's schedule and simply providing a definition of senior lay member in the 1889 Act, which links clearly to the meaning set out in this bill. Because of Amendment 25, there is now a need to define senior lay member rather than chairing member within the 1889 Act. I move Amendment 3 and ask the committee to support my amendments, as well as Mr Maxwell's Amendment 4B. For the reasons I have given, I ask Mr Maxwell not to move Amendment 4A. If that amendment is moved, I would ask the committee to reject it. Thank you.
Thank you much, Cabinet Secretary. I will now speak to myself to Amendment 4A and other amendments in the group. These amendments 4A and 4B that I've submitted to the committee this morning are on the back of discussions clearly with the sector last week in relation to amendments 3 and 4 laid by the government. Now, the clear view of many in the sector was that amendment 4 in particular, and as the Cabinet Secretary said, sections 3 and 4 in particular, the view was that it may indeed be the case that these transferred the some responsibilities for the matter of the governing body, which rather than being for each institution to determine, would have changed the role of rectors and given the power of that change to each governing body to set the rules. And that was something that was not welcomed. Now, in an attempt to resolve this matter, I laid amendments 4A and 4B on Thursday morning. Members will remember, of course, that on Thursday morning we had an electronic problem which left no email or printing methods or any other methods. So it was, and this is my fault, a rather scrambled situation on Thursday morning to attempt to solve the matter. So therefore, in trying to resolve it, I fully accept the government's view about Amendment 4A and indeed the number of individuals that I've spoken to from the sector over the weekend on Friday and again and by email this morning. It is clear that Amendment 4A has unintended consequences, and that was not my intention. My intention was to leave the situation where rectors would be unaffected by this legislation, and therefore it is not my intention to move 4A. However, 4B, I think, does help with the provide at least comfort, if not more than that, to the sector by removing subsections 3 and 4 and allows effectively a situation, as the Cabinet Secretary has described, that the rectors would remain, the ancients would remain in place as they currently are, and they would not be impacted by this current legislation. And therefore, it is my intention, when we come to the appropriate point, to move Amendment 4B. And with that, can I ask if any other members wish to speak? Liz Smith.
Three and four do actually fundamentally change the role of the rector at universities where that role exists. And this really is at odds with what the Scottish Government promised at stage one. Can I just quote to the committee what the Cabinet Secretary said at that stage? She said, "It is extremely important to remember that the role of the rector and that of an elected chair, who is otherwise known as the senior governor, are very distinct. Yet that is not the case with Amendments 3 and 4. In universities with rectors, there would be two different yet overlapping electorates, which I'm sure, I hope, is not the Scottish Government's intention. It's my understanding that University Scotland took legal advice on the issue, which concluded that there is very considerable ambiguity in the drafting, and that it seems likely that the rector would take on the two specific roles of the senior governor, namely the responsibility for the leadership and effective operation of the governing body, and ensuring that there is the appropriate balance of authority between the governing body and the principal. But then, within that institution, you would then find that there is an advertisement, an electoral process for a disempowered position. So again, I hope that that is not the Scottish Government's real intention. So just as worrying is the fact that in universities with rectors, with the exception of Edinburgh, of course, the government amendments would mean that staff would be excluded from the electorate of the position that is most empowered. And again, that is something that is not acceptable. Amendments 4A and 4B, I understand, convener, why you brought them forward. I have some sympathy for that, but the fact that they are there is an acknowledgement that Amendments 3 and 4 have created a real mess in the bill. While they are an attempt to preserve the rector role, they do not do anything to address the fundamental weakness with the Scottish Government's proposals, which mean that there are overlapping electorates and an unworkable system, which, quite frankly, is just not acceptable to the sector. It would create the instability and, as University Scotland argue, the possibility of a considerable argument over which post has the stronger and more democratic mandate. Convener, this section of the bill is a real mess, and it's very regrettable, as I think we all believe, that some real effort was being made to find a consensus which was acceptable to all parties. Now, quite frankly, that has blown apart completely, and I cannot think anything will solve this other than starting again on this section. Students and staff are not at all happy about this situation, and quite properly, university courts worry about the destabilising effect on their institutions. In short, it demonstrates everything that is wrong with the bill. Indeed, I think the last meeting that the Scottish Government had with all the stakeholders was way back at the end of November, and I understand that there's been absolutely no consultation whatsoever between Stage 1 and Stage 2, and that is something for the people who are actually going to have to deliver this is just not acceptable.
Thank you very much. Can I call Mark Griffin?
Thanks, Convener. I think I would have to agree with a lot of what Liz Smith has said there. I think the Government were working towards a consensus around this legislation, but these amendments, particularly 3 and 4, do seem to have blown that apart. And in our report, Convener, at Stage 1, this committee said that the role of Rector, a historic and often high-profile figure in Scotland's ancient universities, should be clarified. If there are to be elected chairs and elected rectors, then there should be no ambiguity about their respective roles, and both figures should be able to work together for the good of the institution. And unfortunately, I think rather than clarifying the situation from this situation, I think the Government have muddied the waters further with these amendments. At Stage 1, Cabinet Secretary said that your aim was not to change the role of the Rector, but as far as I can see, the amendments that are tabled 3 and 4 do exactly that. I think that's either a change in position from the Government or an error in the drafting. I think what we would like to see is proper consultation with the sector, which, as far as I can see, hasn't happened. That we would ask the Government to withdraw these amendments, to work with the sector to build the consensus that did seem to be coming together in advance of Stage 3. And I would look for the Cabinet Secretary to withdraw these amendments.
Thank you. Can I call Tavis Scott?
Thank you very much, Convener. And firstly, Liam McCarthy's apologies. I'm sure you're familiar with the trials and tribulations of Logan Air. I could do 10 minutes on that. So I was an hour and a half late in Aberdeen last night and got a speeding ticket on the way down. So in the best of moods to take on these amendments. Can I say that the thing that strikes me most about reading all this yesterday and this morning is the assertion by government that they have consulted on these matters. My reading of the situation is that there may have been some consultation, as Liz Smith and others mentioned, much earlier in the process, but when government brings forward fundamental changes to law, because that's what we're going to be dealing with today, fundamental changes to law, they shouldn't be doing that as rushed amendments at the last possible stage. And that's what the Cabinet Secretary has tabled today. Fundamental and important changes to how our universities are to operate in the future, effectively being pushed through Parliament without any real proper pre-legislative or any other kind of legislative scrutiny. And I think government should be embarrassed by that and admit that that is wrong. And Mark Griffin's right. The government should withdraw these amendments, go back to the sector and work out the right thing to do. It can't be the right way for Parliament to operate in this way. I'm told that there's nothing that could be described as the product of consultation or consensus in the government's amendments today. The idea of electing both the rector and the senior lay member attracted no consensus in the meetings that took place during Stage 1, not after Stage 1, but during Stage 1. So the government cannot assert that they have consulted adequately on this matter at all. And it's not just universities, principals, chairs and courts who have been making these points more widely. It's also the president of the Students Representative Council at Glasgow University. He said, I saw the other day that he was perplexed as to how the Scottish Government had managed manage this bill so profoundly, from inadvertent clauses that risked turning Scotland's universities into public bodies to utter ignorance of the relationship between the role of the rector and the role of the chair of the court. This bill, he said, has been an unmitigated disaster. Well, I'd have thought any government should pay pretty close attention to that by people who are, after all, knowledgeable about their sector. And that verdict of disaster, is one that's epitomised by the amendments the Cabinet Secretary's moved this morning. I'm told that the Minister said she would not seek to change the role of the Rector in earlier assurances to the Committee and to Parliament, yet that is precisely what these amendments today do. They also set out in extraordinarily elaborate detail the mechanism to be used for advertising and electing a senior lay member who has effectively been disempowered. I'm not sure what government wants to achieve by that kind of micromanagement of the public sector. Nor, as Liz Smith was mentioning earlier on, for the universities with rectors, except Edinburgh, these amendments would exclude staff from voting for the person substantially empowered as chair of the governing body. And that just seems, frankly, extraordinary. I say to my good friend Ian Gray, it sounds like Labour's old electoral college, that one. But these different but overlapping electorates will be asked to vote for two separate people with poorly differentiated roles on the governing body. That cannot be good policy or cannot be a good approach. So I also acknowledge, Convener, your attempts to get the Minister out of the hole she's dug for herself in the amendments you've moved, or the amendment you're moving today. But that does not get round the fact that this, what is being put in place, is an essentially unworkable system of overlapping roles and functions. What the Scottish Government is doing is to build in an incentive for an effective arm wrestle between rectors and elected chairs whose democratic mandate is the greater. And I cannot believe that is a good way to conduct any kind of future reform of our university sector. If the government's intention really is to avoid altering the role of the rector or setting up in conflict to the senior lay member, I'd also urge the government to withdraw these amendments and to seek to find some way to work constructively with the university on a solution that honours the earlier commitments given, certainly are not being honoured by today's amendments from the government.
Thank you. Can I call Ian Gray?
Convener, around this table we come at this from different starting points. I think Labour have supported the Scottish Government in the principle of seeing chairs of courts in our universities elected. Others have not supported that principle. But I think that we are all agreed on what was committed to by the Cabinet Secretary at stage one, and that is that she would bring forward amendments at this stage which would provide, firstly, clarity on the process of those elections of chairs, and secondly, clarity around the relationship in the ancient universities between that position and the ancient position of rector. It seems very clear to me that the Cabinet Secretary has failed to do that. To bring such amendments forward, it would surely mean bringing them forward with some evidence of support or at least acceptance from the different interest groups within the sector, rectors themselves, the institutions, the staff trade unions, and NUS representing students. But the truth is, and we all know this, that instead of bringing these amendments forward and creating clarity and consensus that they are a good way forward, what we've seen late last week is when these amendments came forward, they rather added to the ambiguity and have led to bewilderment, in fact, on all sides. And any possibility of a fragile consensus being created within the sector to take these proposals forward was rather shattered. Like Mr. Scott, Convener, I appreciate the attempts that you have made to try and dig the government out of the hole in which they have put themselves. That isn't really your job, I think, and it's unfortunate that you've been put into that position. But I have to agree with colleagues that given the situation we've arrived at, the only sensible way forward is for the Cabinet Secretary to withdraw these amendments, to recommit to what she did indeed promise at stage one, and at stage three is to bring forward amendments where she can demonstrate that they are indeed clear and that they have support or at the very least acceptance amongst the sector. That would be the most sensible way forward now.
Thank you, Ian. Can I call Chip Brodie?
Good morning. May I say, Convener, I will support 4B because I think, and I made my position very clear from the beginning, that to have two individuals on the court elected by the wider franchise, I believe will not achieve consistency, and neither will it, in fact, it will probably enhance points of conflict, which are not desirable. But in doing so, I think that your amendment helps alleviate, if not eliminate, that issue. I'd also like to comment on Section 3.3, which I welcome, that another member of the governing body of a higher education institution may be selected by the governing body to exercise any of the functions mentioned in subsection 2, which is leadership and effectiveness, and establishing an appropriate balance of authority. So I welcome that, and I will be supporting your amendment.
Thank you. No other contributions, therefore can I call the Cabinet Secretary to wind up.
Thank you very much, Convener. This Government is making good on its commitments to protect the statutory provision for rectors. And, you know, I have to, you know, inform and advise committee, and I'm sure many members already know this, that there has been extensive consultation in November with the sector. Whether that's with University Scotland, whether it was with rectors, whether it was with the trade unions, or whether it's... Certainly.
Could the Cabinet Secretary tell us just how much consultation there has been with University Scotland and the chairs of court between stage one and stage two to try to build the consensus?
There's been extensive consultation between my officials and all stakeholders. There have been workshops convened because we were pressurised, instead of having regulations to give powers to the model of elected chairs, that we were pressurised to remove regulation making power and to state on the face of the bill. So there have been two very specific workshops in terms of the model of elected chairs. There has been specific engagement with rectors and, of course, discussions in and around the model of elected chairs, of course, you know, strays into the area of ensuring that the role of senior lay person and the rector is appropriately dovetailed. And I was very pleased to receive correspondence from Kathleen Styler this morning, who has welcomed my attempts to retain the statutory role of the rectors in the ancient universities. And she says, "You have always been throughout our discussions clear that the Scottish Government would continue to support the role of the rector and the statutory rights to preside over our university court." And as I said in my opening remarks, Convener, Amendments 3 and 4 are very much with a view to addressing the position of the senior lay member and the interaction with the role of the rector. And for clarity, could just let me make this point, please. And for clarity, in terms of subsections 3 and 4 of Amendment 4, as lodged on the 2nd of February in my name, that also enables all universities with a rector, should they wish to do so, to allow the rector to take on some of the role described for senior lay members in Amendment 3. And there is already that flexibility that exists within ancient universities to dovetail the roles of the senior lay member with rectors. Subsections 3 and 4 merely make expression for that provision. Mr. Gray.
If it is in fact the case, as the Cabinet Secretary implies, that there has been widespread consultation and that there is widespread agreement to this approach in the sector, can I ask her what is to be lost then by withdrawing these amendments just now, taking the time to demonstrate to us that that acceptance and agreement is there, and then making the change at stage 3? Nothing would be lost.
Well, I think that the fundamental issue is that there is a misunderstanding of what the government's provisions were attempted to do. There has been consultation with chairs of court, University of Scotland, Edinburgh rectors, as well as a wider group of rectors. Have clearly stated the rationale for Amendment 3. And in terms of subsections 1 and 2 of Amendment 4, that is about making good our commitments to protect the role of rector, and I see no need to be rolling back on that here and now. I've already indicated in terms of Mr. Maxwell's amendment that we could accept Amendment 4B where we don't go any further than protecting the statutory role of rectors as it is. Yes.
Cabinet Secretary, can I just repeat the quotation that you gave at the Education Committee when you said that it is extremely important to remember that the role of the rector and that of an elected chair, who is otherwise known as the senior governor, are very distinct. Amendments 3 and 4 do not do that. Could you comment?
No, I have always been crystal clear, either in plenary debates in chamber or indeed stage one evidence at this committee, that the senior lay member and the rector are very distinct roles. But it's important to recognise that Amendment 4, in terms of subsections 1 and 2, where the rector has the right to preside and has a deliberative and casting vote at meetings, that the Amendment 4 seeks to protect these functions, and therefore I see no need to roll back from that commitment, a commitment that we made very clear at various stages in the bill. Certainly.
The Cabinet Secretary said in her earlier remarks that there was widespread misunderstanding of the intention of these amendments. Now, I don't doubt the Cabinet Secretary's good intentions to deliver what she promised at stage one, but she herself has acknowledged that there is widespread misunderstanding as to whether, in fact, these amendments do that. What is to be lost by simply taking these amendments away, addressing that misunderstanding, and coming back at stage three with something that everyone can sign up to?
Well, Convener, I contend that there is no dubiety with regards to Amendments 3 and 4. Well, not in terms of the government's intentions, and indeed, as Mr. Gray could perhaps have acknowledged, that I have received correspondence from a colleague of his, welcoming the government's, efforts in this area. Amendment 3 is very clear, and subsections 1 and 2 of Amendment 4 are very clear, and I've already indicated that the government is content in terms of Mr. Maxwell's amendment. So I am clear that others may have misunderstood the intent of these amendments, but these amendments are clear. Finally, yes.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way, and I totally take the point that she's clear about it. Could you tell the committee on what date she or her officials discussed these amendments with the university sector?
Well, I mean, members will be aware that amendments were laid last week, but I have to stress we have had extensive discussions with all stakeholders regarding most of the aspects of this bill. And I do have to accept that there are some people that will never be content with this bill or indeed some of the provisions. But Amendment 3 and subsections 1 and 2 of Amendment 4, I would have hoped that we could have all have been agreed that that protects the intentions that we've discussed at length at this committee to protect the statutory provision of rectors in our ancient universities.
Yeah, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Therefore, the question is that Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not all agreed. There'll be a division. Would those members who wish to support Amendment 3 please vote now? Those opposed? Thank you. Abstentions? the result on the vote on Amendment 3, that amendment is agreed to. 5 in favour and 4 against. There are no abstentions. Can I call Amendment 4 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 3, Cabinet Secretary, to move formally? Moved. Can I call Amendment 4A in my own name, already debated with Amendment 3? I will not move that amendment. I'm debating with myself here, sorry. Can I call Amendment 4B in the name of myself again, already debated with Amendment 3? I'll move that. Question is that Amendment 4B be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That's agreed. The question is that Amendment 4 as amendment be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I ask that again. The question is that Amendment 4 as amended be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Thank you. Can I call Amendment 5 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, grouped with Amendments 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 27, 28, 29, 12, 31, 13, 14 and 15. Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 5 and speak to all amendments in the group. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener. The Scottish Government amendments in this group are chiefly focused on setting out the process that Scottish higher education institutions would be required to follow in appointing their senior lay member. Throughout Stage 1, we listened to the views of stakeholders and took note of the evidence gathered by committee. In addition, we engaged senior sector stakeholders in workshops related to this and other parts of the bill at the end of last year. Amendment 5 is the first in a suite of amendments effectively replacing Section 1 as introduced with provision on the face of the bill rather than in regulations for a single model of the appointment of the elected senior lay member of higher education institutions governing bodies. This amendment obliges an higher education institution, when a vacancy for the senior lay member arises, to delegate responsibility over the recruitment process to a committee featuring at least one student and one staff member drawn from the institution. These committees are commonly known as nominations committees. However, the role of committee formed to appoint an elected senior lay member is not one of nomination, rather selection to stand for election against criteria devised by the committee. Subsection 2 of the provision allows for the committee to determine relevant criteria for the role of senior lay member, encompassing key principles of competence. The intention is to allay previously raised concerns from some stakeholders about who might be elected to lead governance of an institution. Amendment 6 would oblige higher education institutions to advertise a vacancy for the post of senior lay member to the general public through established methods to attract interest from a wide range of candidates. Subsection 2 sets out plainly the obligations required in relation to the advertisement. The intention is to advertise widely and fully inform potential applicants of the nature of the role and what the recruitment process will involve further down the line. The requirement for an application to be in a certain form and for relevant criteria to be made available will ensure a fair playing field for all applicants and that their applications are considered in a consistent way. It is worth noting that existing legislation already obliges an institution to make appointments to its governing body in a way which encourages equal opportunities and does not discriminate against any individual with characteristics protected by equalities legislation, such as race, gender or disability, to name a few. The advertisement and application stage is an important part of improving access to the position of senior lay member. Amendment 7 seeks to ensure that if, in response to the advertisement of a vacancy in the position of senior lay member, an applicant has submitted an application on the correct form and met the criteria set out for the role of senior lay member by presenting sufficient relevant evidence on the application form, the committee must invite that applicant to attend an interview for the role. In short, very much like any transparent and modern recruitment exercise. If at the interview the applicant again satisfies the committee that they meet the criteria for the post, they will be entitled to stand for election for the role of senior lay member. Lastly, subsection 3 of the section inserted by Amendment 7 requires every HE institution to offer applicants reimbursement of reasonable expenses incurred in connection with attending an interview, in keeping with the intention of the Bill to respect the autonomous nature of HE institutions. It will be for each HEI to determine what is reasonable. Turning to Amendment 8, this amendment provides that a higher education institution will be required to convene an election for the position of senior lay member of the governing body if more than one candidate is, after interview, entitled to stand and confirms their intention to stand. If an institution fails to identify two candidates who fit the criteria for the role, the Bill will require that it repeats the process from the point of advertisement. In this way, the Bill ensures a real and meaningful election in keeping with the Bill's overall aims to establish an open, transparent and more democratic appointment process across all higher education institutions for the role of senior lay member. Turning now to Amendment 9, this amendment provides detail on the franchise, mechanism and result of the election of senior lay member of the governing body. Specifically, it provides that the franchise must consist of the governing body themselves and all staff and students of the HE institution. This makes clear this government's intention to democratise the process in appointing a senior lay member and to allow everyone in the institution's community a say in who that should be. Amendment 10 sets out the final step in the recruitment process and provides that the winning candidate at the preceding election must be appointed to the position of senior lay member and that this is the only way in which such a position may be filled. On a connected note, Amendment 11 will replace Section 2 of the Bill with provision on the face of the Bill rather than in regulations for remuneration of the senior lay member. This will ensure that a senior lay member of the governing body can request and will be paid reasonable remuneration from the higher education institution, commensurate with carrying out the functions of that office. This payment will not amount to a salary. The relevant amount must be reasonable and commensurate with work that has been done. Given that Amendments 3 to 11 make provision on the face of the Bill for the appointment and remuneration of the senior lay member, Amendments 12 and 13 remove the regulation making powers in Section 1 and 2 of the Bill as introduced. Furthermore, the purpose of Amendment 14 is to remove Section 3 of the Bill as introduced, which obliges Scottish ministers to consult with higher education institutions and other appropriate persons prior to making regulations under Sections 1 and 2 of the Bill as introduced. Amendment 15 is a consequential amendment which ensures that all Scottish HEIs must include the new elected senior lay member as a member of their governing bodies. This amendment is necessary in order to replace reference to the chairing member in section 41A of the Bill as introduced. Taken together, I would hope that committee can support amendments 5 to 15. Turning to Amendment 31, lodged by Liz Smith, I do not believe that this amendment is necessary as it provides for a power that already exists. Higher education institutions can currently provide remuneration if they wish. Compliance with the Code of Good Governance in this respect is also currently required. My Amendment 11 will, however, ensure that a senior lay member or chair of the governing body can request and will be paid reasonable remuneration commensurate with the responsibilities of carrying out the function of that office. This is not akin to a salary or unlimited payment, but it is right for a senior lay member to request reasonable remuneration and allowances for the work that they have done and a duty on higher education institutions to make such payments where reasonable. I therefore cannot support Amendment 31, which describes a discretion that HE institutions already have, and would ask Ms Smith not to move this amendment and the committee to reject it if she does. Finally, turning to Amendments 27, 28, 29, lodged by Mr MacArthur, I do not believe these will have a positive impact on the process for the appointment of the chairing member. The principal aim of this bill is to enable a framework of governance that is more modern, accountable and inclusive, and I consider that Liam MacArthur's amendments would make little substantive change to current practice, effectively returning us to status quo and leaving the decision-making in terms of the process for the appointment of the chairing member as at present to the governing body to create its own rules about and to restrict the electorate for the chairing member to the members of the governing body only. While Mr MacArthur's amendments include a requirement for the rules to include provision for students and staff to be represented in the process of selecting candidates for election, the amendments simply allow for, rather than require, an institution to undertake an election. As such, Mr MacArthur's amendments make no provision for consistency across the sector, as the amendments would allow different rules to be developed by different institutions, albeit with regard to the Scottish Code of Good Higher Education Governance. The principles underpinning this bill are to enhance inclusion, participation, transparency and consistency in governance arrangements in our HEIs. Unfortunately, none of Mr MacArthur's amendments would meet any of these principles on their most basic level. For that reason, I ask Mr MacArthur not to move his amendments and the committee to reject them if he does. The amendments I have lodged in this group provide for consistency, for robust selection and fair election. We have consulted with and listened to stakeholders and responded to their concerns by setting out what should happen on the face of the bill. I would hope that they are supportive of this considered approach. Convener, I move Amendment 5 and ask the committee to support my amendments. For the reasons I've given, I would ask the committee to reject Amendments 27, 28, 29 if moved, and Amendments 31 if moved by Liz Smith.
Thank you very much. Can I call Tavish Scott to speak to Amendment 27 and other amendments in the group?
Thank you very much, Convener. That's very kind of you. Let me first of all observe that this does really seem a government who want to absolutely be on top of every detail of what goes on in our universities. I was quite taken aback by the Minister's contribution to this debate this morning. I totally understand her sincerity in moving that, but this really now is quite breathtaking in the desire to be all over every detail of what goes on across this aspect of university activity. And I think that approach is wrong. And I thought she gave the game away right at the end there, where she said Liam MacArthur's amendments weren't right because they allowed different universities to come up with different options. Well, that says it all, doesn't it? You know, we're all to do exactly what the government say. So let me make the argument for the amendments 27 to 29, because instead of the unbelievably detailed and mechanistic approach taken by this government, what these amendments seek to do is provide a workable framework for the election of chairs of governing bodies, giving institutions appropriate discretion to set out arrangements for this. And I'd have thought this committee, above all committees in this parliament, should believe in the discretion in education. These amendments require that this should be done in accordance with standards set out in the Higher Education Governance Code. The Cabinet Secretary rightly mentioned that, although they went on to say it didn't really matter, which, unlike primary legislation, is subject to regular change as good practice evolves. I thought that was the whole point of the Higher Education Governance Code. This is something, when ministers previously appeared before this committee in relation to other pieces of legislation, they told this committee that was right, and it was the means to achieve what's loosely described as future-proofing, which strikes me as a pretty dreadful phrase we all use in public life these days. These proposals would absolutely require the engagement of students and staff in the process of selecting the chairs of governing bodies. And yes, that might be different across different institutions. Well, I would have thought that would be a strength of that approach rather than a weakness, as this government appear to believe, primarily through the membership of the nomination committees that select candidates. Amendments 27 to 29 have the added advantage of delivering exactly what the Cabinet Secretary said she previously wanted to achieve. They leave the role of the rector untouched and allow institutions to avoid the nonsense of having student staff elections for both the rector and the senior lay member. Now, Convener, I'm sure members who have much more experience of this committee than me will look closely at these measures, but it must be important that the committee tries to save the government from itself here, instead of allowing this hole to be dug ever deeper, and that's what these amendments do. The overly detailed and interventionist approach of Amendments 5 to 11 will simply store up problems for the future. Amendment 5 illustrates this perfectly, while Amendment 6 sees ministers attempting to write into primary legislation, primary law, every last detail of a job advert, while removing any scope for universities to negotiate remuneration and allowances with their chair. That is an extraordinary level of influence, if not the heavy hand of the law, over the practical activities of an independent institution. And I would urge the committee to think about that rather than just passing it on the nod. In this context, I think the more flexible and pragmatic approach set out in Liz Smith's Amendment 31 is more sensible. Amendment 8 fails to address the problem of the governing body being denied the opportunity to elect its own chair, which must be deeply ironic in the context of this Parliament and what we've decided to do with committees, but there we go, nothing surprises me any longer. As for the introduction of a measure allowing candidates to claim election expenses, that has emerged, I'm told, from nowhere. It's supported by no evidence, including indeed the costs, which will presumably be borne by the universities, and looks to me like smacking of understandable populism on the part of ministers. The Minister's Amendment 12, which removes Section 1, is right, but I would certainly urge the committee to replace it with a more flexible and proportionate framework set out in Amendments 27 to 29, along with Amendment 31, rather than the, I think, unworkable prescriptions put forward this morning.
Thank you, Mr. Scott. Can I call Liz Smith to speak to Amendment 31 and other amendments in the group?
Thank you, Convener. This amendment is required because it countermands one of the Scottish Government ones, which is based on payment on demand rather than on need. Amendment 31 requires decisions about the remuneration of chairs to be made in accordance with current and evolving best practice, which is very important, set out in the Higher Education Governance Code, based on the need for remuneration or allowances to enable someone to discharge that role in the circumstances of the institutions. It also removes ministers from decision-making role in relation to remuneration of chairs. Could I also agree with every comment that has been made by Tavish Scott regarding Amendments 27, 28 and 29? I think he's absolutely right. If there is anything that has led to the success of our universities, it is their diversity and their ability to respond to increasing global competition. And so to condition this down to what the government says is quite frankly not acceptable. Amendment 5. Having disempowered the senior governor institution with rectors, the Scottish Government has now set out the criteria for the selection of the senior governor, whether or actually they actually have that meaningful role. So the Code of Governance provides for a process that's far more competent than what is expressed in the amendment, so I cannot see any reason to support that Amendment 5. In Amendment 6, since the Code already requires transparency and compliance, which I have to say is required by law, there is absolutely no need for the oversimplification in this process, in this amendment. As Tavish Scott rightly says, it is centralisation of the worst sort. Indeed, I think it actually makes me wonder whether the Scottish Government really knows what it's talking about when it comes to how advertisements in national newspapers actually appear and whether they would ever consider setting out the full description of the post and how applicants could claim their expenses. Furthermore, the expectation that a university will pay for people to campaign, be it the senior lay governor or whoever else, is utterly ludicrous. This has never been the subject of consultation, nor has the cost been addressed in the financial memorandum, a document which, as the committee knows, has already been torn apart by the Finance Committee, and it shows clearly that they have in mind a very competitive adversarial election along the lines of the election of student officers. So I think there are serious concerns about Amendment 6. Amendment 7, the real worry about that amendment is the fact that it provides the Nominations Committee with very little more than a tick-box role for determining whether the candidate fits the criteria that are actually specified. And I have to say that I believe that that has been written with ignorance about modern effective practice when it comes to selecting people for senior roles. It gives no capacity to the Nominations Committee to make a judgment about who among the so-called tick-box candidates has the strength of skill, experience and commitment to that institution's mission. Amendment 8. The committee is well aware that University of Scotland remains wholly unconvinced of the wisdom of having an election of chairs from a body that is out with the governing body, which is in itself inclusive of staff and students. It rightly points to examples in the outside world and indeed within the Parliament's own committee structures, which are held up as good practice precisely because the governing body is the group which elects the chair. And there's a good reason for that, namely the essential need to ensure that there is a full trust between the chairman and the governing body. If that trust is broken, the whole institution is undermined, and that, Cabinet Secretary, is why there's been such an outcry from so many quarters. But there are two other crucial failures in this amendment. In the highly possible event that there is only one willing candidate, it provides for paralysis for an indefinite period. Again, any institution operating without a chair is likely to be in a very difficult position. Secondly, and I understand that there was no consultation about this, nor was it even mentioned at stage one, it creates an absurd situation of institutions paying candidates' campaign expenses. As far as I can see, that's not been costed, and it's very likely to attract vexatious campaigners who do not have the institution's best interests at heart. In fact, this amendment is one of the most problematic in the whole bill, and we certainly can't support it. Amendment 9, this gives by far the greatest power to choose a role about long-term view of the institution to the most transient community, the students. If there is to be an election with student and staff franchise, there should be equal weighting for the electoral colleges of governing body, students and staff. Institutions would need to be able to make rules about who qualifies as members of the electorate. For example, is it acceptable that a student doing a distance learning over a short period of time overseas then becomes part of the electorate? This has not been thought through. Amendment 10, obviously this amendment is related to amendments 3 to 9, but I ask the question again, what happens when there is only one candidate under Amendment 8 and an appointment can't be made? Amendment 11, I have to say I think this is open to abuse because it is effectively payment on demand, and as such I think it would attract some of the wrong people. It restricts itself to disempowered senior lay members and not the empowered rector, and we saw comments in the newspapers yesterday about that. So again, Cabinet Secretary, I think there are serious implications for Amendments 5 to 11, and I would ask you to think again about them. I move Amendment 31.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I call Chick Brodie?
I said in my previous offering that a consistency is a major feature, as is reducing points of conflict. And of course, there has to be, given the momentum behind the educational institutions, a degree of flexibility. Section 6, 7, 8, and 9, if I turn to my consistency, I've made it absolutely clear in the past, and I will do so again today, that I'm against the election of chairs on a wider franchise. I did, in making my offerings, suggest that there was a mechanism by which directors elected by the wider franchise could co-chair the court with the senior lay member, or whatever he or she is called, on the basis that the rector could chair those items on policy, which would direct the direction of the universities, but the operational, day-to-day operation, should be convened and chaired by a lay member elected by the court. Now, one of the things that I, first of all, I'm concerned about, and why I asked my earlier question, was the point in section 8.2, as proffered, is that the election is to be postponed until the election can be held with more than one candidate. Now, that could go on a very long time, particularly because those that we, I believe, that might aspire to be the senior lay member or the chair or what have you, may not wish to go through an election process. That said, what it does make very interesting is, if that election were to be postponed, let's say for a year to get the candidate, we then have a situation where another member of the governing body, I asked the question earlier, of a higher education institution may be selected by the governing body. So here we have a situation where, while we're waiting for the election, we have someone in position who's elected by the governing body. I fail to see why that is relevant. And if I may also look at, I think it's section 9.5, which talks about, we're looking for two or more candidates. Let's suggest that we have three candidates for the highest number of votes cast. Then the election is won by whichever of them is deemed to be the winner in accordance with whatever the rules are. Now, let's say that the person who wins actually has less votes than the aggregate of the other two. Now, someone mentioned the parallel with this situation, but with this parliament, which is true in a constituency vote, but of course we use proportional representation by top-up. So what we're actually saying is we're going to have a chair, senior lay member, convener, whatever, elected possibly on a minority of the franchise. Not only are they elected on a minority of the franchise, they then have to persuade a body that has had no say in appointing them in engendering trust. And I'll come to issues about certainly removal of members and other amendments along those lines later. So yeah, I'm actually confused by the whole process. And I repeat, I will not be supporting the issues where an election for a chair is being recommended on the basis of just these few things. I mean, I could go on about the vetting process and how good is the vetting process. Do we get the candidates put forward that have the appropriate skills? I do agree with involvement of student and staff at the appropriate level, certainly in the election of directors, and certainly in helping to put forward a candidate or candidates to the court for election. But I think that, having mentioned, I hope, my consistency, which I believe to be as constructive as possible, also avoids us reducing what will be, I assure you, will be major points of conflict.
Thank you. Can I call George Adam?
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to talk about Amendments 8 and 9 that Angela Constance already put forward. You know, for me, this is it sets out the arrangements for the election of the franchise, and the heart and soul of this bill is the democratisation of the process. And I think us sitting here in this place, we should not fear democracy. We should not fear the idea that we actually bring people that are involved in the communities and these institutions, involved in their institution, to actually push everything forward. We should not back away from that. For me, that is the heart and soul of this bill and something that we should be promoting all the time. And when you look at the process that's in place as well, and obviously Amendments 5, 6 and 7, where they say there will be a sifting process to ensure that the right candidate is put forward, so that we don't have a situation where there is someone that may be going down the routine just in order to get some form of publicity. So I believe that if we reject any of these amendments that I've spoken of, we actually take away the fundamental principle of this bill, which is to ensure that every single person that's involved in that institution gets the opportunity to actually be part of the institution and move things forward.
Are you taking an intervention?
That's, yes, I will.
The point I made earlier in terms of policy and having the rector, you know, elected and on that basis elected by the wider franchise to secure their attendance to project policy, which is clearly the driver for any institution, would allow us to make sure that that democratisation actually applies at the very point of policy projection. And I don't understand why, you know, that is not acceptable.
Mr. Brodie, I know you're a man of principle, but the principle of this actual bill is to make sure that we open up the democratisation and make sure that more people get involved in the process. And that is the important part here, and that is the message that we want to send out in these institutions. Because for far too long, this has been a closed process. This has been a process that could, and I'm not saying there has been issues, but could, because of its lack of openness and transparency, could actually be accused of not actually giving the delivery and decisions being made quietly in secret corridors of power within our institutions. I'm not saying that is the situation, but that could be perceived by individuals. Yes, I will.
Mr. Adam, would you agree that irrespective of what is the democracy process, and there isn't a person around this table who doesn't want to see democracy and transparency in our universities, would you accept that with many of the Scottish Government's amendments, it is the process about which we are trying to achieve that is so fundamentally flawed?
Well, this is where you and I disagree, Ms. Smith, because I can actually see the process, that how it can actually work for the institutions to deliver what we all want to do. Because the whole point, as I said earlier on, you know, let's not fear democracy. Let's not actually get to a situation where we leave these institutions and don't allow to empower the people involved in the educational institution communities. I think that's the important part of this bill, and I think it's the heart and soul of this bill. So I would say to everyone, encourage everyone to support 5, 6, 7, and particularly 8 and 9.
Thank you very much. Mr. Adam, can I call Mary Scanlon?
Yes, Convener, I'm really just seeking some clarity, and it follows on from what George Adam has said. And George, I agree with Liz Smith, there's no one that doesn't want democracy and transparency and accountability in every part of public funding in Scotland. But I wonder, Convener, if I could just drill down slightly on Tavish Scott's point, and particularly in relation to Amendment 6. And it's really just to ask the Cabinet Secretary if she could clarify some points in her summing up today. Since I came here in 1999, we've passed a lot of legislation and a lot of absolutely life-changing legislation, and rightly so. And we have an excellent reputation in this Parliament for doing so. However, today we're looking at our world-class universities. We have universities in this country that are within the top 100 in the whole world. Not in Scotland, not in the UK, not in Europe. We have world-class universities here. I think it's important to put that on power, on the record. But George's point about the secret corridors of power, I'm actually shocked that these learned individuals in our world-class universities have to be told in legislation to put an advert on their website. To put an advert on their website and to tell people how they can get an application for them. I mean, is that really what the legislation of this Scottish Parliament is about? Do these universities not know about technology? Do they not know that it's fairly regular occurrence when you have a vacancy for a senior lay member to put an advert on their website? And do they not know that it's important that people know where to get an application form? So what I'm seeking from the Cabinet Secretary is, where's the problem? Mm-hmm. Where's the secret corridors of power? Where's the secret deals? Where is the necessity to put in primary legislation to tell our world-class universities to put an advert on the website and to tell them where to direct people for an application form? I actually find that quite embarrassing, to be sitting here passing legislation. Democracy is one thing, but the micromanagement and arrogance of this is quite something else. I seek clarity from the Cabinet Secretary on that point.
Thank you very much, Ms. Scanlon. No other members indicated they wish to contribute. So, Cabinet Secretary, can I call you to wind up?
Thank you very much, Convener. It's important to put on record that the model provided for essentially what was recommended in the Vaughan Pronzinski review. And I was, throughout this process, always alive to the objections raised by many members about the regulation-making powers that were contained in the bill as introduced. And therefore, with lots of consultation and discussion with all stakeholders, what the government has put forward today is a model in which to elect a chair on the face of the bill. It is important to also recognise that this bill is discreet, the provisions are high level, and they are focused. And yes, they do seek for consistency across the 18 HE institutions in Scotland. And where, you know, I just have to disagree with some colleagues is that the code of good governance, quite simply, does not go far enough, either in terms of that process around appointing the chair, or indeed around the issues of remuneration. And in terms of the paralysis alluded to by Liz Smith and others, obviously Amendment 3, as identified by Mr Brodie, allows for the business of the governing body to continue. But it is important that when we legislate, that we do so in a way that is robust and does not allow people to sidestep the issue of elections. So we have to be very clear that where there are not enough candidates to have an election, that the process of advertisement has to recommence. And I think it is... certainly.
On that basis, I understand, I think if you cut any of us in the middle, you'll see democracy running through it. But I'm still unable to understand why, particularly if you're wanting more candidates to stand for election, why it is okay for the governing body to elect over a period of time, which could be, you know, a year or longer, that the governing body can elect its own senior lay member, chair, convener for that period of time.
Well, of course, Mr. Brodie,
where is the attainment of your democracy?
I'm sure you would be the first to point out the paralysis of boards not being able to be chaired properly. So, of course, there is provision in event of there not being a timely election. But I think it is beholden on this government and those who believe in democratically elected chairs that the legislation is indeed robust to ensure that elections actually occur. And if you at first don't succeed, you do indeed have to try again. And the importance of the provisions in relation to advertising, we have to ensure that universities advertise widely to ensure that we do indeed get cast the net widely in terms of candidates so that we do have an election. And of course the relevant criteria as laid down in the government's provisions are of course very important. There is an opportunity for the committee, which includes representatives of staff and students, to be taken into account the needs of the individual institutions, but it is important that they are looking at the skills and attributes of the candidate and that they are, as part of that, that the candidate has the trust and confidence of the board. So it is imperative that in legislation that we set out, you know, the role and function of the committee and indeed the entitlements of candidates who meet that criteria to go forward to an interview and indeed an election. And with regards to election expenses, well, this again is aimed at ensuring that candidates who will have, you know, a variety of means and circumstances in their personal lives. And it is important that if we want to cast that net widely and enable a diversity of candidates, a diversity of high quality candidates to come forward, it is not unreasonable. Certainly.
Has this issue been costed?
Well, it's for, as I was going to go on to say, it's for the individual HE institution to decide what expenses are reasonable, and that is in terms of expenses for interview or indeed expenses in relation to carrying out the role of senior lay member or indeed election expenses. So this is a matter for the institutions themselves to decide in what is reasonable, proportionate and affordable and commensurate with the role. So it is most certainly not micromanaging to any regard. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Therefore, the question is that Amendment 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No. Sorry, Liz, you don't have a vote. No, so, well, you can't speak for somebody else, with all due respect. Thank you, Mary. We are not agreed. Therefore, there will be a division. Could all those who wish to support Amendment 5 please vote now? Okay. Are those opposed? Okay, thank you. I don't think there's any abstentions. Yes. Abstentions? The result of Amendment 5 is that there were 7 votes in favour and 2 against. Therefore, that Amendment 5 is agreed to. Can I call Amendment 6 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary? Question is that Amendment 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not all agreed, therefore there'll be a division. Would those who wish to support Amendment 6 please show? Thank you. Those against? Okay. Abstentions? The result of the vote on Amendment 6, 6 votes in favour, 2 against and 1 abstention, the Amendment 6 is agreed to. Call Amendment 7 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 7.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? No. If not, there shall be a division on Amendment 7. Therefore, can I ask those who wish to support Amendment 7, please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Thank you. The result of the division on Amendment 7, 6 votes in favour, 3 votes against. That amendment is agreed to. Can I call Amendment 8 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary? Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 8.
Moved.
Question is that Amendment 8 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not all agreed. There's a division. Therefore, would those who wish to support Amendment 8 please vote now? Those against? The result of the division on Amendment 8, there were 6 votes in favour and 3 against. That amendment is agreed to. Can I call Amendment 9 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary? Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 9.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 9 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed. There will be a division. Can all those who wish to support Amendment 9 please vote now? Thank you. Those against? The result of the division on Amendment 9, there were 6 votes in favour and 3 votes against. Amendment 9 is agreed to. Can I call Amendment 10 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary? Cabinet Secretary to move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 10 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not all agreed. There will be a division. Therefore, the question is that Amendment 10 be agreed to. Would all those who wish to vote in support of Amendment 10 please vote now? Okay, thank you. Those against? Thank you. Abstentions? The result of the division on Amendment 10, 6 votes in favour, 2 votes against, and 1 abstention. Amendment 10 is therefore agreed to. Can I call Amendment 11 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary? Cabinet Secretary to move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 11 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not. There should be a division. Therefore, all those who wish to support Amendment 11, please vote now. Those against? Thank you. Abstentions? Thank you. The result of the division on Amendment 11, there were 6 votes in favour, 2 votes against, and 1 abstention. Amendment 11, therefore, is agreed to. Can I call Amendment 27 in the name of Liam MacArthur? Already debated with Amendment 5. Tavish Scott to move or not move?
A move, Convener.
That's moved. The question is that Amendment 27 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not all agreed, therefore there shall be a division. All those who wish to support Amendment 27, please vote now. All those against? Thank you. The result of the division on Amendment 27, 2 votes in favour, 7 votes against. The Amendment 27 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 28 in the name of Liam MacArthur, already debated with Amendment 5. Tavish Scott to move or not move?
Move, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 28 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not all agreed, therefore there shall be a division. Can I ask those who wish to support Amendment 28, please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Abstentions? The result of the division on Amendment 28, there were 2 votes in favour, 6 votes against, and 1 abstention. Therefore, Amendment 28 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 29 in the name of Liam MacArthur? Already debated Amendment 5. Tavish Scott to move or not move?
I move, Convener.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 29 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not all agreed. Therefore, there was a slight pause, but it was not agreed to. Therefore, there will be a division. Can all those who wish to support Amendment 29 please vote now? Thank you. All those against? Abstentions? The result of the division on Amendment 29, 4 votes in favour and 4 votes against and 1 abstention. Therefore, I have to use my casting vote, and therefore I will vote against Amendment 29, the result being there that, therefore is that Amendment 29 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 12 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary? Already debated with Amendment 5. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 12 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Thank you. Can I call Amendment 30 in the name of Liz Smith? It's grouped with Amendment 63. Liz Smith to move Amendment 30 and speak to both amendments in the group. Liz Smith.
Thank you. The Scottish Government's proposal when it comes to the election of chairs, I think it risks the situation where you may end up with people who want to campaign on a single issue which is possibly at odds with the governing body's overall policy. For example, somebody wishes to retain a particular subject at the university or a facility and that governing body regards as academically poor or financially unsustainable. I think it also risks the governing body having great difficulty if the elected chair proves to be unfit for office, since it makes no provision whatsoever for the removal of that person. So Amendment 30 is designed to do that. It does make the necessary safeguard for a governing body to be able to remove a chair who becomes unfit for governance for office and who, most importantly, loses the trust of the governing body. I move Amendment 30.
Thank you very much. Can I call Trigg Brodie to speak to Amendment 63 and the other amendment in the group? Mr. Brodie.
Thank you, Convener. I think we talked earlier of the Appointments Committee, and I strongly agree that those who seek to see a convener appointed should certainly include as wide a range of those people that will be affected by the talents of all the individuals in the institution. However, it seems to me that one of the points that George Adam made very effectively was this whole business of making sure that the institution is effective. And I would hesitate to use a phrase like, you know, bug in the stern or what have you, but it's very important in that appointment process, which should be as rigorous as possible, that not only do we require the skills and the talents of individuals, but we also require their commitment. It seems anachronistic to have, you know, for example, rectors who cannot, will not, or unable to attend regular court meetings. So I think while we look at the introduction to the court of people with, as I say, with these skills and talents, we must also recognise that the continued improved outcomes of the universities require a robust attention from everyone. And that particularly includes those that sit on the governing body. And if it is found that a member of the governing body is unable to attend and input, or unwilling indeed to input, and that may, I don't want to go back over what we just discussed, but that's a possibility, or if they're found to be unsuitable, then in being able to help improve the performance outcome of the university, then the suggestion in my amendment is that there should be a mechanism for removing or requesting the resignation of said individuals.
Thank you very much. Are there any other members who wish to contribute the stage? No? Well, therefore, I'll call the Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener. I'm grateful to Liz Smith and Trigg Brodie for explaining the intent of Amendments 30 and 63. However, I do not consider these amendments to be either necessary or desirable. Insofar as both amendments are unnecessary, HE institutions already have powers to deal with the resignation or removal of both the chair and other members of the governing body, and they will most likely already have their own arrangements in place. Moreover, the amendment I've moved today will ensure the process for filling a vacancy in the position of senior lead members that's carried out efficiently and fairly. As I've said already, Convener, the intention of the bill is to make provisions which are high-level and focused, featuring discrete measures aimed at providing a strengthened framework for governance across the entire sector, making it more modern, inclusive and accountable. So this high-level framework is intended to work with existing provisions, which means that the bill will enable existing arrangements covering resignation or removal of any member of the governing body to continue. I know that some have called for the sort of detail contained in Amendments 30 and 63 regarding resignation and removal and wanting that to be included in primary legislation. However, as I've said, if someone is not performing adequately, the institutions already have the ability to deal with that, whether in relation to the elected position or not. Certainly.
I wonder if you, you may not be able to, but it would be helpful if you were... advise how many members of courts have been removed or asked to resign in the course of their tenure?
I don't know the answer to that question. That's maybe one to be directed at the institutions themselves. But the important point is our HE institutions are currently free to finesse their current arrangements to deal with these situations if they so wish. And I don't have anything further to add, Convener, but since Mr Brodie and Ms Smith's amendments curtail that autonomy of institutions, I cannot support Amendments 30 or 63 and would ask committee to reject these amendments if they are pressed.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Can I call Liz Smith to wind up and to indicate whether she wishes to press or withdraw her amendment?
Thank you, Convener. I have to say I'm very confused by what the Cabinet Secretary has just said in terms of the... I think Chip Brodie's point is absolutely correct. I don't see how it undermines the autonomy principle. Indeed, I think that it gives the universities... It is important that we have this safeguard in place to ensure that there is the facility to remove a chair for somebody who becomes unfit for office. And I come back again to the fact that the crucial thing about the person who is chairing that and also the governing body is the fact that there is the utmost trust between them. And it seems to me that that is, well, I don't think it's recognised through the whole bill, but it's certainly not recognised in these sections. I think Chip Brodie makes a very strong point in this respect. So I will press Amendment 30.
Thank you very much. The question is that Amendment 30 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not all agreed, therefore there'll be a division. Would those who wish to support Amendment 30 please vote now. Thank you. Those against? The result of the division on Amendment 30, 5 votes in favour and 4 against. Amendment 30 is agreed to. Can I call Amendment 59 in the name of Liz Smith, grouped with Amendment 60, 61 and 62. Liz Smith to move Amendment 59 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. And can I move Amendment 59? And can I also at this stage just say that I have been working with Sandra White on this issue and have great sympathy for the comments that she's made both in the Chamber and obviously within the course of her amendment. I think the entire conservatoire, sorry, it was a slip of the tongue there. I'll say that again. The conservatoire community, which I stress is including elected staff and student governors, is opposed to the proposal to elect the chair of the Board of Governors by an electorate other than the board itself, for exactly the same reasons that we discussed just a little while ago. The Conservatoire believes that an election would be especially divisive and disruptive given its scale, which is roughly 1,000 students and 40 full-time academic staff, and its disciplinary focus. Such a process will sow the seeds of division, they believe, and I think it will lead to a politicisation of the role of the chair. Related to the scale, the Conservatoire believes that its current system of representative democracy is very effective and much more likely to deliver a good chair than would a more widely drawn plebiscite. The Conservatoire's Board of Governors includes two academic staff governors, one directly elected. the other nominated by the academic board. That's a ratio of one academic staff governor to 22 staff. The board includes two student governors. That's a ratio of one student governor to 500 students, and that's obviously quite different from any large university. Because of its scale and culture, elected staff and student representatives can be relied upon to reflect the views of colleagues and fellow students, and that was a very strong message we got when we had the round table at the Education Committee. Under its current arrangements, it would be inconceivable for the Conservatoire's board to appoint a chair in the face of opposition from elected student and staff governors. Its nomination committee already includes two staff and two student governors, which exceeds actually the requirements of the bill. And accordingly, clause 4 above makes explicitly the need for a chair to have the support of not only the majority of all governors, but also the combined majority of staff and student governors within that overall majority. So the Conservatoire believes that election by plebiscite will put good candidates off applying. The Conservatoire is as much a performing arts institution as it is an HEI. So obviously that's a very important consideration about the discrete qualities that it has. And therefore, I think there is an unnecessary imposition of the election process will make it very difficult in that. So, as I say, I move Amendment 59.
Thank you very much, Liz. Any other members wish to contribute? Tavi Scott.
I just support, thank you, Convener. Can I just support the tone of these amendments in this area? My understanding is that the Royal Conservatoire, in all capacities, staff, students, management and stakeholders have all made clear their opposition to the bill's provision applying to their institution in the way in which Liz Smith has illustrated this morning, and it set that out in the context of the widest possible cross-section of its stakeholder community, a pretty decent principle given some earlier considerations we've had this morning. I also would suggest that the concerns that have been illustrated this morning illustrate the risks inherent in taking such a blunt instrument as law to something as diverse and complex as our university sector. The very nature of what is being illustrated here demonstrates that. Now, there are others, of course, in the sector who probably have similar, indeed I certainly know have similar or differing concerns as to seeking an exemption to all or part of this bill. The UHI is certainly one in my part of Scotland, but if the Minister can reassure us in the later amendments that something can be done on that, that would be clearly helpful and important. But these are the right amendments in terms of the exemption that's sought in this area.
Nicole Sandra White.
Thank you very much, Chair. I agree with what's already been said in respect of the Conservatoire and in some cases also the Glasgow School of Art also, which I'll speak to my amendments further on, which are basically based on the fact that they are small specialist institutions. They already adhere to the von Provinsky, you know, recommendations and criteria also. And having met with the Conservatoire and the representatives from the Glasgow School of Art also, they feel as though the governance that's set up at the moment, which they already have, actually fits the criteria which this you know, bill would be looking forward to. So I would certainly support the amendments here in Liz Smith's name. And I would just recommend the fact that the Conservatoire, as already been mentioned, is a specialist institution, a worldwide institution, and they do have trade union representatives on their governing board also, as does the Royal School of Art as well.
Thank you very much, Mrs. White. No other members have indicated the wish to contribute at this stage, so can I call the Cabinet Secretary?
Thanks, Convener. I've listened carefully to Ms. Smith and to other colleagues and their explanation of the intent of Amendments 59, 60, 61 and 62. However, I cannot support them principally because they make specific arrangements for only one of our HE institutions, and that cuts across the very heart and purpose of the bill. As we've said already today, the principal aim of the bill is to enable a framework of governance that is more modern, accountable, inclusive. And we, of course, welcome the diversity in our HE sector and, in particular, value the contribution made by the Royal Conservatoire to our tertiary sector. However, I have been clear, Convener, that this is a focus bill featuring discrete high-level measures aimed at strengthening governance across the entire sector, applying a consistency of approach that should apply to all institutions. We do have the same ambitions for the Royal Conservatoire as we do for our other 17 institutions. And I do not anticipate that any of the 18 Scottish HE institutions to which Part 1 of the Bill applies will be unable to meet the requirements of the Bill, particularly as institutions will be able to work towards full compliance over the transitional period during which the Bill is commenced. Amendment 61, Convener, makes it clear that this set of amendments is about retaining the ability of the governing body at the Royal Conservatoire to simply select its chairing member, so that only members of the governing body of the Conservatoire would be entitled to vote. And that would exempt the Royal Conservatoire from one of the core aims and provisions of this bill. And for that reason, and others, I ask the committee to reject amendments 59, 60, 61 and 62 put forward by Liz Smith if they're pressed.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Can I call Liz Smith to wind up and to indicate whether she wishes to press or withdraw her amendment?
Thank you. I've listened carefully to what the Cabinet Secretary said, but I think there's a fundamental point here, which actually the Cabinet Secretary will know was a recommendation that came from Ferdinand von Pradinsky when he made it all these months ago, and that was that he believed that there could be separate discussions to be had about the specialist institutions. Now, it seems to me, Cabinet Secretary, that these discussions have not taken place. I think the Royal Conservatoire make excellent recommendations about the workings which work for them, and I don't think any of us could criticise just how successful that institution has been as the way that Sandra... Yes.
It was my understanding of the von Pradinsky review that he said that they should be included.
Von Pradinsky's review made it very clear that further debate would have to be taken about the workings of these. I have his quote here, Cabinet Secretary, if you would like it thereafter, but he's very clear about that. He said that they have very special circumstances and that the review has not had time to consider these. So, you know, there is an important point here, and I think we should be careful with the facts. Secondly, I know that we will come to an amendment in the name of Mr. MacArthur later on. I think it's Amendment 66, which looks at the overall possibility of exemptions. But, you know, it's back to the question about the diversity of our HEIs. I mean, they are extremely diverse. Their success lies in that diversity, and that's the reason why I think the Royal Conservatoire make very good points. So I will press Amendment 59.
Okay, thank you very much, Ms. Smith. The question is that Amendment 59 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not all agreed, therefore there shall be a division. Would all those members who wish to support Amendment 59 please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Abstentions? Nope. The result of the division on Amendment 59, there were 2 votes in favour, 7 votes against. Therefore, Amendment 59 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 60 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 59. Liz Smith to move or not move?
Moved.
That's moved. The question is that Amendment 60 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not all agreed, therefore there shall be a division. Would all those who wish to support Amendment 60 please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Thank you. The result of the division on Amendment 60, 2 votes in favour, 7 votes against. The Amendment 60 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 61 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 59. Liz Smith, to move or not move?
Moved.
That's moved. The question, therefore, is that Amendment 61 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not all agreed, therefore there'll be a division. Would all those who wish to support Amendment 61 please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Thank you. The result on the division on Amendment 61, there were 2 votes in favour and 7 votes against. Amendment 61 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 62 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 59. Liz Smith, to move or not move?
Moved.
That's moved. Therefore, the question is that Amendment 62 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not all agreed. Therefore, there'll be division. Those who wish to support Amendment 62, please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Thank you. The result of the vote on Amendment 62, 2 votes in favour, 7 votes against. Therefore, Amendment 62 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 31 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 5. Liz Smith to move or not move?
Moved.
That's moved. Therefore, the question is that Amendment 31 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not all agreed. Therefore, there'll be a division. Would those who wish to support Amendment 31 please vote now? Thank you. Those against? Abstentions? The result of the vote on Amendment 31, 4 votes in favour, 4 votes against and 1 abstention. Therefore, I'll have to use my casting vote again and I vote against. Therefore, Amendment 31 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 13 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 5. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. Thank you. Can I call Amendment 14 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 5. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 14 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That's agreed. Can I call Amendment 15 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 5. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 15 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes,
yes we are. Thank you. Can I call Amendment 32 in the name of Liz Smith, grouped with Amendments 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 16, 39, 17, 40, 41, 42, 18, 1 and 50. Can members please note that Amendment 34 preempts Amendments 35 and 36 and that Amendment 42 preempts Amendment 18. With that in mind, Liz Smith to move Amendment 32 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener, and can I move Amendment 32? These amendments in my name to Sections 4, 5 and 6 protect the democratic nature of staff and student membership of governing bodies. On the student side, these amendments enable institutions to provide for directly elected student members, as well as or instead of nominees of the Students' Association, which provides for an enhanced level of democracy. Currently, the most common means of selecting student governors is for the elected sabbatical office holders of Students' Association to fill these roles, typically one being the student president, joining explicitly ex officio, and the second being, by convention, other elected sabbatical. However, there are also 4 directly elected student governors in the sector across 3 institutions. Any of these arrangements has a democratic element lacking from the simple nomination by Students' Associations. On the staff side, these amendments require all staff members of governing bodies to be elected rather than simply nominated by local trade union leaders who typically represent less than 1/3 of staff. To retain the capacity of academic boards or senates to elect academic staff members to governing bodies, which is obviously a very important connection between the bodies responsible for the overall governance of the institution and the bodies responsible for institutions' academic leadership, currently 51% of staff governors, excepting senior management, come to the governing body from the academic board. That's achieved through amendments of sections 4.1b and 5.3b, so that academic boards or senates can elect members who count as elected staff for the purposes of the bill. The amended section 4c gives trade unions their proper place, as for instance in the University of Glasgow, in running elections to the governing body, which are open to all staff rather than just a minority of staff who choose to join trade unions. Without these amendments, we will inevitably see elected members of staff of governing bodies displaced by trade union nominees. Even without the requirement for alumni governors, the new governors required by Section 4 would leave 6 HEI governing bodies in breach, one or both of the code's requirements for A, no more than 25 members, and B, a majority of independent members. For example, the addition of 2 union-appointed governors would leave Glasgow University's court at 26 members, of which 50% would be independent. To comply with the code as adopted by the SFC, it would therefore be necessary to remove at least one non-independent member from the court. While the bill does not specify how this would be done, in practice the sole point of the flexibility, especially in the case of something like Glasgow, the cohort of staff elected to the court senate on the academic board. So that's a very important principle in ensuring that there is greater democracy and accountability.
Thank you very much. Can I call Tavi Scott to speak to Amendment 35 and other amendments in the group?
Thank you very much, Convener. Can I move Amendment 35 and those others in that you have mentioned, as they represent an attempt to rectify a somewhat strange and patronising assumption in the bill that characterises some staff as simply support rather than professional in their own right. And I would hope that change would be supported by the committee and indeed by the government. Amendment 39 addresses the anomaly by which this bill gives recognised trade unions the right to nominate governing body members in institutions that do not have recognised trade unions. Again, that is an attempt, convener, to ensure that this blunt bill does not take a one-size-fits-all approach to a sector as diverse as higher education and incorporates sufficient flexibility to enable that it may work as best as to fit the circumstances of each institution. Very much in that spirit, I support the government's amendments 16 and 17 in relation to graduate associations. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I call the Cabinet Secretary to speak to Amendment 16 and other amendments in the group?
Thank you, Convener. The overarching aim of Section 4 of this bill is to advance the inclusivity of the governing bodies over higher education institutions, enabling every voice on campus to be heard. Amendment 16 removes the requirement for the inclusion of the two graduate members nominated by a graduates' association of the institution. While there is no doubt that a graduate of an institution would be of considerable value to many governing bodies, most governing bodies will naturally attract graduates. I have carefully examined the evidence provided to this committee, and I acknowledge the challenge in meeting this requirement for those institutions which do not currently have a formally constituted graduates association, like the Glasgow School of Art and Glasgow Caledonian University. And in acknowledgement of that challenge, I now seek to remove this requirement from the bill. The amendment of the bill in this manner will reduce the number of statutory members of the governing body required by the bill from 9 to 7. As we heard in evidence, many institutions already have individuals on their governing bodies who, if elected or appointed under the bill's procedures, would fill 5 of the remaining 7 statutory positions. As such, this amendment will also enable institutions to more easily comply with both the requirements of the Bill and the Scottish Code of Good Higher Education Governance, which suggests a maximum of 25 members as a benchmark of good practice in terms of the size of the governing body. Amendments 17 and 18 are consequential on Amendment 16, removing the definition of a graduate from the bill and removing provisions for the nominations process for graduate members, respectively. If Amendment 16 is accepted, these provisions will no longer be necessary. Turning now to Amendment 1, this removes the power at Section 8, enabling Scottish ministers to amend by regulations the categories of governing body membership set out in Section 4.1 of the Bill and the number of persons to be appointed under a particular category. I have listened and given full consideration to all issues raised by all committees in respect of this bill. I've also listened and examined carefully the written evidence provided by stakeholders. And while I may not agree with their assessment that Section 8 of the bill poses a risk of reclassification of higher education institutions as public bodies by the Office for National Statistics, on reflection, I consider that removing this power, which is not essential, will provide further comfort in this regard. Moving now to Amendments 32, 33 and 41 from Liz Smith, which seek to amend Section 4 of the Bill. I've listened to Ms Smith for her explanation of the rationale behind these amendments. Subsection 1B of Section 4, as introduced, requires that the membership of the governing body includes 2 staff members elected by the staff of the institution from among the staff of the institution. The amendment of this section by Amendments 32 and 33 introduces an alternative option of filling those 2 staff positions with 1 person appointed by the academic board of the institution and one person elected by the staff of the institution, and this is something that I have given consideration to. While I'm not opposed to the membership of any governing body, including members drawn from another important body such as the Academic Board, I do not consider it necessary to provide for this in this section. Because of my Amendment 16, because that reduces the number of members required by the Bill to only 7, this means every HE institution will remain able to fill a further 18 positions on the governing body from wherever they wish within the confines of the Code. While Amendments 32 and 33 are not necessary, Amendment 41 is simply too restrictive in its framing of the electorate for these staff positions. It would enable the governing body to choose to restrict the electorate and the pool of candidates for the election of staff member positions to members of the Academic Board. That would be to the detriment of the inclusivity which I want to support through this bill. I therefore ask committee to reject Amendments 32, 33 and 41. My proposal, convener, to provide for membership on the governing body of trade union nominees are among the most far-reaching and innovative in this bill, and I'm proud that it is this government which is introducing them. Amendments 34 and 42, also from Liz Smith, provide an alternative approach which I cannot support. I believe that trade unions deserve more than simply an administrative role. Furthermore, Amendment 34 provides for no trade union involvement at all where there is no trade union officially recognised by the HE institution. However, through subsection 4.2b, all that is required for official recognition under the bill is that an HE institution recognises it as representative of the category of staff. And this should always happen where a trade union has members who are staff of the institution. I want to thank Tavish Scott for explaining the intent of Amendments 35, 36, 40 and 50. The Scottish Government considered fully and carefully the wording to be used in retrospect of the categories of staff being described throughout the bill. The terms academic staff and support staff are well understood in the sector. They are used in various governance orders in relation to the post-1992 institutions and can take their ordinary meanings much in the same way as the terms teaching staff and non-teaching staff do in the legislation relating to colleges. I do believe the issues in this bill are too important to be having debates about semantics when a term is widely already understood in the sector. And the support staff in our institutions are essential to the smooth operation and good governance of these institutions, and they do very important work, and this bill ensures that they too are given a voice on the governing body of the HE institutions. The bill, is also absolutely clear about the extent of its application and introducing new overlapping terms and unnecessary definitions would not be helpful, I believe. To introduce the term professional staff would, I think, muddy the waters, as academic staff would commonly be understood to be professional staff also. However, if there have been concerns raised by unions or staff on this matter, I would be happy to discuss it further, either with Mr. Scott or Mr. MacArthur, or indeed others, in advance of Stage 3. As such, I ask the committee to reject the amendments laid in Mr. MacArthur's name. Turning to Amendments 37 and 38 from Liz Smith, these amendments would enable HE institutions to make a choice between filling the two mandatory student positions on their governing bodies, either through the appointment by nomination process already envisaged by Section 4.1e of the Bill, or by a new added election process in which students could stand and vote. As introduced, Section 4 of the Bill obliges HE institutions to have two student members on their governing body nominated by a students' association of the institution from among the students of the institution. And while I'm not sure that institutions would welcome an attempt to require them to conduct more elections, Liz Smith's commitment to creating a democratic mandate for student members is, of course, laudable. but it does not take into account that in most cases, members of students' associations who are nominated to serve in governing bodies or other bodies have already been elected to an office of the students' association by their fellow students. Whoever is nominated is already likely to have a mandate from students. A particular difficulty with Amendment 37 is that it leaves it to the discretion of HE institutions whether both student places are to be nominated or elected. And I am clear and comfortable with the provisions as drafted, which leave it to the students themselves to nominate members to represent their interest. However, I am glad that we agree that student influence on the governing body of their higher education institution is essential. Amendment 38, Convener, is unnecessary. Section 6 of the Bill already provides for the governing body of the Higher Education Institute to make rules in accordance with which the nomination process must be conducted, including in relation to nomination by Students' Association under Section 4.1e. So I ask committee to support my Amendments 1, 16, 17 and 18 and to reject Amendments 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42 and 50 from Liz Smith and Lee MacArthur if they are pressed.
Thank you very much. No other member has indicated to wish to contribute. Therefore, can I call Liz Smith to wind up and to indicate whether she wishes to press her withdraw her amendment?
Thank you, Convener. Can I first of all begin by saying how welcome it is that Section 8 of the Bill has been removed. That was something that should never have been in the Bill in the first place and caused great angst to the entire sector, whether it was students or staff. So I'm very pleased that the Government has seen sense on that and sought to take that out. The Cabinet Secretary has referred to the fact that this is about increasing democracy. It is. It's about increasing democracy for students. But it's also about ensuring that no democracy is diminished, and that is something that would unquestionably happen in some universities who will find that elected members of staff will no longer be able to take their positions, despite the fact the Cabinet Secretary says she's going to look at that. Cabinet Secretary, you made reference to the fact that semantics, you don't want to get bogged down in semantics. Semantics are a key part of any bill. And therefore, it is a very important thing to look at the semantics of the drafting. And may I suggest, Cabinet Secretary, that one of the reasons we have such considerable difficulty over this bill is because the semantics have been so unclear. I move Amendment 32 in my name.
Thank you very much. The question is that Amendment 32 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not all agreed, therefore there'll be a division. But those who wish to support Amendment 32, please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Okay, thank you. Abstentions? The result of the division on Amendment 32 were 2 votes in favour, 5 votes against and 2 abstentions. Therefore, Amendment 32 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 33 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 32. Liz Smith, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 33 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not all agreed, therefore there will be a division. Would those who wish to support Amendment 33 please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Okay, thank you. Abstentions? The result of the division on Amendment 33, there were 2 votes in favour, 5 votes against and 2 abstentions. Therefore, Amendment 33 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 34 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 32, and can I remind members that Amendment 34 preempts Amendments 35 and 36. Liz Smith, to move or not move?
Moved.
That's moved. Therefore, the question is that Amendment 34 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not all agreed, therefore there will be a division. Would those members who wish to support Amendment 34 please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Thank you. Abstentions? The result of the division on Amendment 34, 2 votes in favour, 5 votes against and 2 abstentions. Therefore, Amendment 34 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 35 in the name of... Excuse me, is that not preempted? No, sure. So So can I call Amendment 35 in the name of Liam MacArthur, already debated with Amendment 32, Tavish Scott, to move or not move?
Move, Convener.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 35 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not all agreed, therefore there'll be a division. Those who wish to support Amendment 35, please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Thank you. Abstentions? The result of the division on Amendment 35, there were 2 votes in favour, 5 votes against and 2 abstentions. Therefore, Amendment 35 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 36 in the name of Liam MacArthur, already debated with Amendment 32. Tavish Scott, to move or not move?
Move, Convener.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 36 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not all agreed, therefore there shall be a division. With those who wish to support Amendment 36, please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Thank you. Abstentions? Thanks. The result of the division on Amendment 36, 2 votes in favour, 5 votes against and 2 abstentions. Therefore, Amendment 36 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 37 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 32. Liz Smith, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 37 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not all agreed, therefore there's a division. Those who wish to support Amendment 37, please vote now. Those against? Abstentions? The result of the division on Amendment 37, there were 2 votes in favour, 5 votes against and 2 abstentions. Therefore, Amendment 37 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 38 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 32. Liz Smith, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 38 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Yes. Not all agreed. Therefore, there's a division. Those who wish to support Amendment 38, please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Abstentions? The result of the division on Amendment 38, there were 2 votes in favour, 5 votes against and 2 abstentions. Therefore, Amendment 38 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 16 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 32. Cabinet Secretary, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 16 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. Can I call Amendment 39 in the name of Liam MacArthur, already debated with Amendment 32. Tavish Scott, to move or not move?
Move, Convener.
That's moved. Therefore, the question is that Amendment 39 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not all agreed. Therefore, there shall be a division. Those who wish to support Amendment 39, please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Thank you. Abstentions? The result of the division on Amendment 39, 2 votes in favour, 5 votes against and 2 abstentions. Amendment 39 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 17 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 32. Cabinet Secretary, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 17 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That's agreed. The question is that Section 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The question is that Section 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Maybe it's my hearing, I don't know. Call Amendment 40 in the name of Liam MacArthur, already debated with Amendment 32. Liam MacArthur, to move. Sorry, Travis Scott, to move or not move?
Move, come here.
The question is that Amendment 40 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Not agreed, therefore there's a division. Those who wish to support Amendment 40, please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Abstentions? Thank you. The result of the division on Amendment 40, 2 votes in favour, 5 votes against and 2 abstentions. Therefore, Amendment 40 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 41 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 32. Liz Smith, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 41 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not, therefore there's a division. Those who wish to support Amendment 41, please vote now. Those against? Abstentions? The result of the division on Amendment 41 was 2 votes in favour, 5 votes against and 2 abstentions. Therefore, Amendment 41 is not agreed to. The question is that Section 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're agreed. Can I call Amendment 63 in the name of Chick Brody, already debated with Amendment 30. Chick Brody, to move or not move?
Move.
move. The question is that Amendment 63 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not all agreed, therefore, with those who wish to support Amendment 63, please vote now. Thank you. Those against? The result of the vote on Amendment 63, there were 5 votes in favour and 4 votes against and no abstentions. Therefore, Amendment 63 is agreed to. Can I call Amendment 42 in the name of Liz Smith? Already debated with Amendment 32. Can I remind members that Amendment 42 preempts Amendment 18? Liz Smith, to move or not move?
Moved.
It's moved. Therefore, the question is that Amendment 42 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not all agreed, therefore there's division. Can those who wish to support Amendment 42 please vote now? Thank you. Those against? Thank you. Any abstentions? The result of the division on Amendment 42, there were 2 votes in favour and 7 votes against. Amendment 42 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 18 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary? Already debated with Amendment 32. Cabinet Secretary, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 18 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That's agreed. Thank you. The question is that Section 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That's agreed to. The question is that Section 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That's agreed. Can I call Amendment 1 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary? Already debated with Amendment 32. Cabinet Secretary, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That's agreed. I'm going to suspend briefly at the moment and give everybody a short break. So we'll have a short suspension before we move on. Can I bring the committee to order, please? And can I call Amendment 19 in the name of Jim Eady, grouped with Amendments 43, 44, 20, 45, 46, 47, 2 and 58. And can I invite Jim Eady to move Amendment 19 and speak to other amendments in the group? Jim.
Thank you, Convener. I'm pleased to introduce and speak to Amendment 19, and I speak as one of the constituency members for the University of Edinburgh. The purpose of this amendment is to remove Section 9 of the Bill, which states that the academic board of a higher education institution is to consist of no more than 120 members. Having already raised this matter directly with the Cabinet Secretary in the Scottish Parliament on the 26th of November last year, I am aware that she has listened to the arguments in relation to removing Section 9 and that she has indicated that she is minded to support my amendment. I therefore welcome the Cabinet Secretary's willingness to take the views of the sector into consideration. The University of Edinburgh already has strong and inclusive governance arrangements, as their governing body incorporates staff, students, alumni and the city, as well as external independent members who bring a breadth and a balance of skills and are appointed through an open, transparent process. The university's system of governance, which has been refined to ensure full compliance with the new Scottish Code of Good Higher Education Governance, introduced in July 2013, is working well and provides appropriate oversight and assurance for the university. The university also has an independent rector, popularly elected by staff and students, the only Scottish university to do so. As it stands, Section 9 of the Bill could undermine the University of Edinburgh's strong and inclusive governance arrangements. I do not believe that that is the intention of the bill. It would also potentially reduce the university's ability to compete effectively, could strip hundreds of their staff, indeed would strip hundreds of their staff from their current rights as Senate members, and provide no obvious benefit to the university. One of the strengths of our university sector is its diversity, as has already been stated by members this morning. The one-size-fits-all approach under Section 9 fails to take into account the different shapes and sizes of higher education institutions across Scotland, and I firmly believe it would be inappropriate for a university as large as the University of Edinburgh, which employs 13,000 staff and has 35,000 students. Taking all of this into account, I hope the Scottish Government will support my amendment and take on board the concerns of the University of Edinburgh, and in so doing, will allow each individual higher education institution to determine the size of its academic board.
Thank you very much, Mr. Eady. Can I call Tavis Scott to speak to Amendment 43 and other amendments in the group?
Thank you very much, Convener. Can I agree with Jim Eady's remarks in terms of the amendment that he's just moved in relation to academic boards? I particularly commend his approach to the Code of Practice and the remarks he made about that, and I might commend his support of that to his own government in that regard as well, given the earlier debate we had. My understanding, you'll forgive me on this one, Convener, is that my amendments, or rather Liam MacArthur's amendments that are in this grouping, are relatively minor, and you'll have to take my word for that. They seek to address references to specific titles and roles that, as things stand, are overly uniform within the bill, and in that context, I hope the committee might consider it appropriate to support them. I also want to just briefly welcome Liz Smith's amendments 45 to 47, which appear to me to put into the bill safeguards preventing ministers from legislating on matters of internal academic governance, which must surely be a sensible principle, and indeed the minister's amendment 20, which also seems to be the right approach. And finally, let me also welcome the minister's amendment 2, removing what I understand to be the controversial Section 13, never necessary, now thankfully on its way out of this bill, and the bill would be all the better for that.
Thank you very much, Mr. Scott. Can I call Cabinet Secretary to speak to Amendment 20 and other amendments in the group?
Thank you, Convener. I want to start by thanking Jim Eady for outlining the purpose of Amendment 19, which is to remove the requirement of HE institutions to ensure that academic boards comprise no more than 120 members. The Scottish Government has listened and given full consideration to this issue as set out in the evidence provided to the Education and Culture Committee. And while the Scottish Government is still of the view that each academic board needs to be of a manageable size and efficiently run, we are persuaded that this can be achieved by a larger academic board. On reflection, we consider that the size of an academic board should be for each individual HE institution to decide, and I am content to support this amendment. Amendments 43 and 44 provide for additional descriptions of the two of the categories of membership of the academic board of a HE institution in section 10 of the bill. The term principal is intended to identify the senior executive member of staff of a higher education institution, regardless of the actual job title which they have. Principal is a term which is well understood among the education sector, and the term is also used in the Code of Good Higher Education Governance, and its meaning is clear as the person who is the head of the institution. I therefore think that under section 10 of the bill, high HE institutions will be clear as to the position to be covered. Similarly, I think that the term head of school is sufficiently understood within the education sector. It is explained in the explanatory notes accompanying this bill as individuals who are the most senior academics of the HE institution. It is already used in provisions in the governance instruments of some institutions setting out the membership of their academic boards. Therefore, I do not consider these amendments necessary and ask committee to reject amendments 43 and 44 moved by Mr Scott. Amendment 20 follows from Amendment 19, which removes the maximum number of members of an academic board. Its purpose is to ensure that, despite the requirement to have students making up 10% of the membership of the academic board, no HE institution is required to have more than 30 students on its academic board. I should point out that any board wishing to have more than 30 students can, of course, still do so. I am of the view that student representation on academic boards or senates should be significant and not token. This amendment continues to protect and enable this aspiration. Significant student representation on the academic board of an institution would still be achieved even if a larger academic board were not required to have more than 30 student members. At the moment, this amendment will only have a practical effect in relation to the Senates of the University of Glasgow and the University of Edinburgh, where Senate membership currently exceeds 300, but it would still be open to those Senates to have more than 30 student members if they so wish, as I've previously indicated. I ask members to support my amendment. In relation to amendments 45, 46 and 47 proposed by Liz Smith, my view is that the removal of sections 10, 11, 12 of the bill would be detrimental. Academic boards play an important role in our HE institutions, providing oversight of academic quality and necessary coordination with university governing bodies to ensure that decision making at all levels is properly informed. We must ensure, therefore, that academic boards are and subsequently remain representative of the main communities within their institution. Section 10 of the bill, therefore, sets out a minimum composition of academic boards and guarantees the participation of elected staff as well as elected student members. We would not want to see any provisions removed where that removal would diminish the intent, purpose and effect of Section 10 as introduced, and I therefore cannot support amendments 45, 46 and 47 and would ask committee to reject these amendments put forward by Liz Smith. The purpose of Amendment 2 is to remove the power in Section 13 of the Bill, which enables Scottish Ministers to amend by regulations the number of members on an academic board specified in Section 9 and to modify the categories of membership of an academic board set out in Section 10(1) and or the number or percentage of persons to be appointed under a particular category. Again, the Scottish Government has listened and given full consideration to all the issues raised by the Finance and Education and Culture Committees in respect of this bill. I have also listened to and examined carefully the written evidence provided by stakeholders, and while I may not agree with their assessment of the risk of the reclassification of HEIs as public bodies by the Office for National Statistics posed by Section 13 of the bill, on reflection, I consider that the power to amend the categories of academic board membership and the number of persons to be appointed under a particular category is not essential. I therefore urge members to support this amendment too. Amendment 58 in the name of Liz Smith, which seeks to restore the provisions relating to the membership of senates at the ancient universities under Section 5 of the University of Scotland Act 1858, is not desirable because this would result in inconsistencies in the rules defining the membership of the academic boards of HEIs. As already stated, a key policy aim of this bill is to embed a level of consistency and approach to governance across institutions, and this applies to academic boards to improve their effectiveness and representativeness in their decision making. Therefore, I cannot support Amendment 58, but I would ask the committee to support Amendment 19 in Jim Eadie's name and Amendments 20 and 2 in my name, and I would ask the committee to reject the other amendments in this group if they are pressed.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Can I call Liz Smith to speak to Amendment 45 and other amendments in the group?
Thank you, Convener. I think it was my colleague Mary Scanlon at the beginning of this morning who asked the question of the Cabinet Secretary, if there isn't a problem, why do we need to fix anything? And this is exactly what the question is when it comes to academic boards. Academic boards should be entirely a matter for self-regulation and for the autonomous institution. I don't really see why it is that we're even contemplating legislation in this regard. In that context, my amendments are designed to try and ensure that we can have as much of that autonomy as we possibly can. I think it was von Prinzinski himself who made recommendations about academic boards at the committee stage one, but the evidence was completely lacking, and that's something that has gone through ever since stage one. There is no evidence as to what it is that's supposed to be wrong with academic boards and senates. I'm delighted, I have to say, that the amendment in the name of Angela Constance regarding the ONS situation, I'm glad that that is going. That, above all else, was about to destroy so much of our university sector, so that is very good news that that is going. I entirely support Jim Eadie in his comments about the University of Edinburgh. I also firmly support the amendments in the name of Liam MacArthur. So I move Amendment 46.
Thank you. Any other members wish to contribute at this stage? I will make a short comment myself. Can I welcome both the Amendment 19 in the name of Jim Eadie on the maximum size? I'm glad that that is going, and I can welcome the government's support for that amendment, because clearly it was something that we questioned witnesses quite closely on in terms of the reasoning for the 120 figure. So I think on behalf of the committee, can I welcome the fact that Jim Eadie has laid the amendment, and in fact also welcome the Cabinet Secretary's support for that amendment. And with that, can I call Jim Eadie to wind up and to indicate whether he wishes to press or withdraw his amendment.
Thank you very much, Convener. I very much welcome the constructive approach which has been taken by the Cabinet Secretary in both listening to and acting upon the concerns which have been expressed by and on behalf of the University of Edinburgh, and I also very much welcome the support from other members of the committee this morning. The government, in agreeing to remove Section 9 of the bill, have, I think, quite clearly recognised the diversity of the sector, and in doing so have introduced a degree of flexibility into the bill which I believe will be welcomed not just by the University of Edinburgh but by the wider higher education sector in Scotland. For all of those reasons, I move the amendment that's been tabled in my name.
Okay, thank you. The question is that Amendment 19 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That's agreed. Can I call Amendment 43 in the name of Liam MacArthur, already debated with Amendment 19, Tavish Scott, to move or not move?
Move, Convener.
Question is that Amendment 43 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not all agreed, therefore there will be a division on Amendment 43. Those who wish to support Amendment 43, please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Thank you. The result of the division on Amendment 43, 4 votes in favour and 5 votes against. Therefore, Amendment 43 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 44 in the name of Liam MacArthur, already debated with Amendment 19. Tavish Scott, to move or not move?
Move, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 44 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not all agreed. Therefore, there's a division. Those who wish to support Amendment 44, please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Thank you. The result of the division on Amendment 44, there were 4 votes in favour and 5 votes against, that therefore Amendment 44 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 20 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 19, Cabinet Secretary, to move formally?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 20 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? That's agreed. Can I call Amendment 45 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 19, Liz Smith, to move or not move?
Moved.
That's moved. Therefore, the question is that Amendment 45 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed. Therefore, there shall be a division. Could all those who wish to support Amendment 45 please vote now? Thank you. Those against? Thank you. The result of the division on Amendment 45, there were 2 votes in favour and 7 votes against. Therefore, Amendment 45 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 46 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 19. Liz Smith, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 46 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not all agreed, therefore there is a division. Would those who wish to support Amendment 46 please vote now? Those against? Thank you. The result of the division on Amendment 46, there were 2 votes in favour and 7 votes against. Therefore, Amendment 46 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 47 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 19. Liz Smith, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 47 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not all agreed, therefore there'll be a division. Those who wish to support Amendment 47, please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Thank you. The result of the division on Amendment 47, there were 2 votes in favour and 7 votes against, therefore Amendment 47 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 2 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 19, Cabinet Secretary, to move formally? The question is that Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? That's agreed. Can I call Amendment 48 in the name of Sandra White, grouped with Amendments 48A, 64, 65 and 49? Sandra White, to move Amendment 48 and to speak to other amendments in the group.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I speak as a local member, which I speak to in 49, Glasgow Kelvin, which the Royal Conservatoire and Royal School of Art, Glasgow School of Art, is placed in my constituency, even though they are worldwide institutions. Amendment 48 is about small specialist institutions. Basically, the Scottish Minister's made. I want to basically emphasise this part. I didn't specifically put in must, I said may. The Scottish Ministers may, by regulations, modify this Act to exclude any or all small specialist institutions from any or all of the provisions of this Act. And in considering whether to make regulations under subsection 1, Scottish Ministers must consult such persons as they consider appropriate, which obviously brings me on to Liz Smith's 48A, which Liz will speak to, obviously, herself. I think 48A is eminently sensible in that respect when we're talking about looking at other institutions. That brings me on to Amendment 49 in my name. It was the meaning of small specialist institutions, and basically I name the small specialist institutions as the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland and Glasgow School of Art. The Scottish Ministers may by regulations modify the definition in subsection 1 so as to include or exclude a particular institution, and regulations under subsection 2 are subject to affirmative procedure. If I could concentrate on this particular one about the meaning of small specialist institutions, Convener, I've already raised this at the education debate also in regards to the Conservatoire and the Glasgow School of Art, both in my constituency, both worldwide institutions, and it's already been said, basically they meet the criteria with their Board of Governors. And I must say that, particularly in the Conservatoire, they do have representations from the EIS, and in the Glasgow School of Art, they have representations from all the unions which is applied to the Glasgow School of Art, Equity, EIS and others also. But the biggest point I want to make, and the one that I think is really, really important, and in this I raise the issue which Jamidi brought up about Section 9. Now, the The Cabinet Secretary was very good to listen to that particular debate and had agreed that there would be a cut-off in the size of the university. And this is a point I want to make and why it's so important about small specialist institutions. Now, Jim Idiot in his contribution mentioned the fact that the Edinburgh University has 1,300 staff and 35,000 students. In the Glasgow School of Art, we have 40 staff and 1,000 students. And not so dissimilar within the Conservatoire. I wanted to put that difference there to show you exactly why we see it as a small specialist institution and why I think the amendments which were put forward by myself and Liz Smith, which I possibly talked to a couple of Liz Smiths also, are very, very important. And obviously, when you look at the situation with the Von Prudinsky review, which was already been mentioned, and basically recommendation that we haven't actually considered small specialist institutions yet, I would ask if the Cabinet Secretary would consider looking at that part of Von Prudinsky's recommendations and perhaps coming back at stage three with something along those lines about small specialist institutions. I think it's really, really important that we recognise just how important these institutions are to not just Glasgow, obviously my Kelvin constituency, but the whole of Scotland. They punch well above their weight. They're world-renowned. In fact, Glasgow School of Art, I think, is one of the 10th in the world of the arts institutions. So that's why I put the comparisons between what Jim Idiot has said about the size of Edinburgh University and obviously Glasgow University, Strathclyde University, which are also there in my constituency. Basically, there is a world of difference between that institution and the small specialist institutions such as the Conservatoire and the Glasgow School of Art. So I'll leave it there just now, if that's all right, Convener, if I can come back and speak to a couple of other amendments that Liz Smith has as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I call Liz Smith to move Amendment 48A and speak to all amendments in the group?
Thank you, Convener. Can I move Amendment 48A? I wonder if I might start with two quotations. The first from Ferdinand von Prudinsky, when he said, and I quote, "We are aware that these institutions, namely the small specialist institutions, may wish to have their special status recognised in particular ways, and we took the view that further consideration may need to be given to them in that context." And her predecessor, Mike Russell, he said that in the case of the small specialist institutions, the application of the terms of the governance code should pay particular attention to the principles of proportionality and the relevance to the nature of the individual institution. So these are the reasons why, when it comes to certain specialist institutions, that I do think we have to be extremely careful that we are not undermining that diversity and that diversity and, as I say, the success that they have. Sandra White is absolutely correct to say that these are world-leading institutions, and by definition, if we try to constrain them in a way just because we want centralisation of all HEIs, we're going to end up in very considerable difficulty. The Conservatoire, Glasgow School of Art, Rural College, I think you could argue too, and HEI, as Tavish Scott mentioned, they're very small and in many ways they have a very different and sort of artistic, I think, is the correct way when it comes to the Conservatoire and the Glasgow School of Art. They're quite different from some of the approaches of the university, and I think we need to recognise that because, as I say, that is their success. The Conservatoire, for example, also has a unique corporate structure. It's a company limited by guarantee with shareholders, who include its elected staff and student governors, which is evidence of the Conservatoire's commitment, I think, to transparency and accountability. And I don't think any of us could argue that they don't have very good relationships with trade unions and with anyone who may have points that they wish to raise. So I think we have to be very careful about what we are seeking to do in this. I think the Scottish Government has failed to define the problem that this bill seeks to solve. And certainly when it comes to the specialist institutions, I think it's actually going to end up creating greater difficulty. So hence the reason why I'll be supporting Sandra White's amendments and obviously my own.
Thank you. Any other members wish to contribute? Okay, can I call the Cabinet Secretary there?
Thank you, Convener. I want to thank Sandra White and Liz Smith for explaining the intent of Amendments 48, 48A, 64, 65 and 49. Having considered them very carefully, I can confirm that the Scottish Government does not support these amendments. As I've said previously, the Scottish Government intends provisions in the HE Governance Bill to apply equally to all 18 Scottish higher education institutions. And I have been clear that provisions in this bill are high level and focused, featuring discrete measures aimed at strengthening governance across the entire sector, making it modern, inclusive and accountable. However, I am satisfied that the existing provision in the Further and Higher Education Scotland Act 2005 already have the balance right in terms of duties on the Scottish Funding Council to report to Scottish ministers on higher education institutions. And I do want to put on record my appreciation for and the value of the role played in our HE sector and indeed wider society by the small specialist institutions such as the Royal Conservatoire, Glasgow School of Art and Scotland's Rural College or SRUC. I am aware of the concerns expressed by the Conservatoire in relation to the provisions in the bill, and board members wrote to me in December to request exemption from the bill because in their view, their collective view, the Conservatoire's current governance arrangements, which are unique among Scottish HEIs, are already fully fit for purpose. Now, this is a view that has been expressed on more than one occasion during this bill process and by more than one institution. And while I respect any view offered, that does not mean I'm convinced that any of our higher education institutions should be treated differently. Consistency of application in the high level requirements in the bill is fundamental to the bill's progress. It is important also to put on record, convener, that the 2013 Von Prinsinski report concluded, where possible, that small specialist institutions should be covered by any legislation, albeit that their special status may need to be considered. However, the range of recommendations for legislation in the original Von Prinsinski report was much wider than the focus content of this bill. Therefore, I believe it is reasonable to propose that the bill's provisions are equally relevant to all 18 Scottish higher education institutions. And it is important that we do debate and give consideration to the special circumstances. But I have not as yet heard, you know, a compelling argument, for example, for the Conservatoire to be exempt, you know, arguments based in size, to be exempt, for example, from the election of chairs or having seven statutory members on its governing body. I'm quite sure that the debate will continue as we move towards stage three. Conservatoire have certainly met with officials and are due to meet Dr. Allen imminently. But it should be noted that the amendments proposed and supported by Liz Smith and Sandra White don't actually include the SRUC either. So, in conclusion, convener, I anticipate that all of our 18 Scottish institutions will be able to meet with the requirements of this very focused bill, enabling every voice on campus to be heard. Indeed, many institutions, including the Royal Conservatoire and the Glasgow School of Art, will already have achieved a level of compliance in practice and have indeed made progress, as outlined by Sandra White. To allow these institutions an exemption would undermine the aims of the bill, and I have the same aspirations for all of our HE institutions, and I am convinced that all of our institutions are capable of achieving these aspirations. Therefore, I ask committee to reject all the amendments in this group if they are pressed.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Can I call Sandra White to wind up?
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you, the Cabinet Secretary, for your reply and your comments. I'm rather disappointed, I must admit. I do think the Conservatoire and the Glasgow School of Art, the reason I didn't put in the rural colleges, nobody contacted me from the rural colleges, so obviously if they don't contact you, you don't raise that particular issue. But I do once again, you know, look at the situation in Edinburgh with the size of staff and students, and contrast that with the Conservatoire and the Glasgow School of Art and the issues they have raised, which obviously Cabinet Secretary is very well aware from letters that's been sent, very worried about the fact that they wouldn't be able to afford to put these, you know, this legislation forward. It may cost them more money, and it may actually lose them some very, very good people to go on the boards. And that's, you know, some of the issues that they have actually raised with us. So I will press my amendments, convener, and I'll move amendment 48.
Thank you. Can I call Liz Smith to wind up on amendment 48A and to indicate whether she wishes to press or withdraw it?
Thank you. I do think this comes back to the democratic processes and the democracy which we all want to see. And I would ask the Cabinet Secretary, what is it about some of the smaller specialist institutions that she could point to where they have actually had specific problems that need to be resolved? In fact, I would argue that in the case of the small specialist institutions, it's the reverse, that they have had a success story and have worked extremely well in the existing governance that they have. So the Cabinet Secretary has argued that she hasn't had any compelling evidence. Neither have we had any compelling evidence that it should be changed. Could I press 48A?
Thank you very much. The question is that amendment 48A be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not, therefore there shall be a division. Those members who wish to support Amendment 48A, please vote now. Okay, those against? The result of the division on Amendment 48A, 4 votes in favour and 5 votes against, therefore 48A is not agreed to. Question is that Amendment 48 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not all agreed, therefore there will be a division. With those members who wish to support Amendment 48, please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Gentlemen, please. The result of the division on Amendment 48, there were 4 votes in favour and 5 votes against, therefore Amendment 48 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 64 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 48. Liz Smith, to move or not move?
The
question is that Amendment 64 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not all agreed, therefore there's a division. Would those members who wish to support Amendment 64 please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Thank you. The result of the division on Amendment 64, there were 4 votes in favour and 5 votes against. Amendment 64 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 21 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 3. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 21 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That's agreed. Can I call Amendment 65 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 48. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Question. Apologies. Can I call amendment? Call amendment 65 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated amendment 48.
And I stress it's about the conservatoire.
Liz Smith to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that amendment 65 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not all agreed, therefore there's division. Those who wish to support amendment 65, please vote now. Those against? The result of the division on Amendment 65, there were 2 votes in favour, 7 votes against. Amendment 65 is not agreed to, and I will have words with my clerks later on. Can I call Amendment 22 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, group with Amendment 66? Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 22 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Moved. The purpose of Amendment 22 is to remove the power which enables Scottish ministers by regulations to include a particular institution in the definition of a higher education institution for the purpose of Part 1 of the Bill. This was a suggestion made by the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee in its report to this committee. We have considered this, and on reflection, we consider that the power to include new institutions is not required. Our policy intention is that only fundable bodies should be covered by the new requirements in the bill, and I am content that there should be no power to add additional bodies beyond those that will fall within the definition naturally. If any new institution is added to the list of fundable bodies, that institution will automatically fall within the definition of a higher education institution for the purposes of the bill. Turning to Amendment 66 from Liam MacArthur, which introduces a process enabling institutions to apply to the Scottish Ministers for exemptions from any of the provisions set out in Part 1 of the Bill. The introduction of such a provision would be to the detriment of the Bill, therefore I cannot support Mr MacArthur's Amendment 67. As said throughout the debate today, a core aspect of this Bill is to introduce consistency in a small number of discrete key areas of governance of our higher education institutions, and this amendment undermines this by enabling the application of the Bill in a manner which differs across institutions. The process set out would provide Scottish Ministers with a far-reaching discretion to determine which provisions of the Bill should apply to which institutions if they were applied for exemptions. I do not think that this is a role which Ministers should have. So I move Amendment 22 in my name and ask that the committee supports this amendment. For the reasons I have given, I respectfully ask that Mr MacArthur and Mr Scott does not move Amendment 66. If it is moved, I ask the committee to reject it.
Thank you very much. Can I call Tavi Scott to speak to Amendment 66 and the other amendment in the group?
Firstly, can I support the Cabinet Secretary's Amendment 22, which further allows exemptions to be made for institutions and enables a greater degree of flexibility in the way this bill operates in practice. It therefore seems consistent in that context to also support Amendment 66, which is yet another attempt to ensure a degree of flexibility across the board, not just for smaller specialist institutions, despite the very able and eloquent way in which Sandra White made the case for two very important institutions in not just in Glasgow, but I would argue in Scotland as a whole. While such institutions, the smaller ones, I mean, while those concerns are undoubtedly most pressing, there is legitimate anxiety right across the sector more broadly about what might happen in the event that the proposals being introduced in this legislation will not lead to the outcomes predicted by ministers. And given what we've heard this morning, that seems quite likely to happen. For example, if there's only one suitable or credible candidate for election, this is a subject to a fairly decent debate, I thought, earlier in our proceedings, as the chair of a governing body, just how would a university be able to respond? Well, we had no answers to that today, and no answers, I suspect, will be forthcoming before this becomes law. But they'll be pretty forthcoming when we all end up in court over this, over such matters. So the Minister, I do apologise, the Cabinet Secretary keeps saying this is a high-level, focused and discreet bill. I think a lot of us would come to a different conclusion as to this being an attempt to, well, not just an attempt, but clearly going to be the introduction of a one-size-fits-all bill right across all aspects of higher education. And that cannot be the right approach. So while Amendment 66 sets in place a process that I would argue is proportionate, is transparent, and allows decisions to be taken quickly, although not in haste, it does importantly mean that ministers would be required not simply to take a decision on any exemption, but to make clear the basis for that decision. And making clear the basis for lots of things in this bill would be a step forward.
Thank you very much, Mr Scott. Can I call Liz Smith?
Just a short comment. I agree entirely with everything that Tavish Scott has said. I think his point, the most important one, is regards the consistency of approach. If we are to introduce flexibility as a result of the Cabinet Secretary's Amendment 22, that is entirely logical and sensible to do exactly the same when it comes to the amendment in the name of Liam MacArthur. I cannot see any reasonable argument that would suggest otherwise.
No other members indicated they wish to contribute at this stage, therefore can I call the Cabinet Secretary to wind up?
Thanks, Convener. Just to be clear for the record, my amendment 22 is actually to reduce Scottish Ministers' powers to you know, change our ability or reduce our ability to change a definition of a higher education institution. And it is simply, you know, a response to the DPLRC. So, you know, my amendment, you know, doesn't do the same or doesn't do what Tavish Scott and Liz Smith have suggested it does. It's not about, you know, enabling flexibility. It's only that a fundable body is, you know, automatically included. And with regards to Amendment 66, I think what's proposed is a pretty bureaucratic process. And it's also important to point out to members that if Amendment 66 passed, there would be no limits on how often an institution could apply for exemption from the bill.
Thank you very much. The question is that Amendment 22 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? That's agreed. The question is that Section 15 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? That's also agreed. The question is that Sections 16 to 18 are agreed to. Are we all agreed? Can I call Amendment 23 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, group with Amendment 23A. Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 23 and speak to the other amendment in the group.
Thank you, Convener. The purpose of Amendment 23 is to ensure that sabbatical officers of a student's association of an institution are not excluded from participating fully in the governance of their institution, even where they are not technically matriculated students of the institution during their period of office. The Scottish Government has given full consideration to this issue, and I thank Gordon MacDonald for raising it at stage one. Our policy intention has been from the outset that all students should be able to participate fully in the governance of their institution. It was never our intention to exclude sabbatical officers from provisions pertaining to the rest of the student population, and indeed I understand that the vast majority of sabbatical officers do remain as students during their term in office. However, I welcome the opportunity to clarify on the face of the bill that sabbatical officers are included, whether or not they remain students during their term of office, as I appreciate that the situation can vary across institutions. This amendment will ensure sabbatical officers, whether or not students through their term of office, are included in provisions in the bill dealing with appointment as a member of the committee which recruits the senior lay member, participation in the election of the senior lay member, nomination as a student member of the governing body, or election as a student member of the academic board. Amendment 23A is a technical amendment. Subsection 2 of the new section inserted by Amendment 23 would only have been required for the purpose of subsections 3 and 4 of the section inserted by Amendment 4. With Amendment 4B, Mr. Maxwell proposes to remove these two subsections from Amendment 4, and as I've explained earlier, I support that proposal. I move Amendment 23 and ask that members support it, and also Amendment 23A.
Thank you. No other members indicated they wish to contribute. I presume, Cabinet Secretary, you don't need to wind up?
Nope.
Thank you. Therefore, can I call Amendment 23A in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 23, Cabinet Secretary, to move formally?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 23A be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That's agreed. The question is, therefore, that Amendment 23, as amended, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That's agreed. Can I call Amendment 49 in the name of Sandra White, already debated with Amendment 48. Sandra White, to move or not move?
Not moved, Davina.
It's not moved. Can I call Amendment 50 in the name of Liam MacArthur, already debated with Amendment 32? Tavish
move,
Scott, to move or not
Davina.
Move? Thank you. The question is that Amendment 50 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
It's not agreed, therefore there'll be a division. Those who wish to support Amendment 50, please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Thank you. Abstentions? The result of the vote on Amendment 50, yes, 2 votes, no, 5 votes, and there were 2 abstentions. Therefore, Amendment 50 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 66 in the name of Liam MacArthur, already debated with Amendment 22. Tavish Scott, to move or not move?
Move, Convener.
Question is that Amendment 66 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not all agreed, therefore there's a division. Those who wish to support Amendment 66, please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Thank you. Abstentions? The result of the division on Amendment 66, 2 votes in favour, 5 votes against and 2 abstentions. Therefore, Amendment 66 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 51 in the name of Liz Smith, grouped with Amendments 52, 53, 54, 55, 56 and 57. Liz Smith to move Amendment 51 and speak to other amendments in the group.
Can I move Amendment 51? I'm still confused and I really don't understand why we should be legislating in the area of academic freedom. The Stage 1 report found no rationale for the Scottish Government to propose legislation in this area. Indeed, I think at the time there was a real concern as to why we were even thinking about it, because there is, to my information, not a problem with academic freedom, and it's not something about which the Scottish Government should get involved. Just to test that out, there were several emails that came into MSPs at the stage when it was first proposed requesting changes to the definition of academic freedom. I personally had 47 such emails, and I got back in touch with each of these members, usually members of staff in the university, to ask for specific examples of how academic freedom was currently constrained. And I'm sorry to say that only one person was able to supply an example, and that was very specific to a piece of research in one particular institution. So I'm really not at all sure what it is that we are trying to do. My amendments in this area have tried to ensure that we can respond to the committee's concern that academic freedom must be balanced with responsibility. It must not be exercised with malice, for instance, or any undercover of the academic freedom a person makes defamatory or gratuitously offensive remarks. And obviously, it must be based on facts and reason, unevidenced assertion by members of academic staff about things outside their professional competence should not be protected by academic freedom. I entirely accept that. And therefore, as I say, the wording in this bill can be interpreted as constraining the governing body's capacity to make the decisions about the overall academic shape of the institution. And I think the amendments, particularly 51, 52, 54, seek to try to ensure that risk is avoided. So I come back to the point, convener, I really do not understand why academic freedom is a problem. I would be interested, actually, when the Cabinet Secretary speaks to these amendments as to whether she feels that there are specific examples whereby a university is in some way prevented from having academic freedom in the current setup. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll speak to my own amendment, Amendment 53, and other amendments in the group. I think we are all agreed that academic freedom is a principle on which the strength and success of our universities is founded. I listened very carefully to what Liz Smith said. I don't think I disagreed with an awful lot of what she said. But I think there is a particular point she made, I think, which is very important, and that is that there is a balance to be struck here between the rights and responsibilities, both of staff and indeed of others in our institutions, or HEIs. Obviously, effectively, I think Liz Smith's amendments and my amendments are slightly competing in this area. So if she accepts my apology that I cannot support her amendments because I'll be supporting my own amendments in this area. But I think the key, as I said, issue here is balance. We must ensure that academics and teaching staff can offer opinion freely and unfettered by consideration of the impact, for example, on their ability to seek or a new appointment or maintain their current appointment. But at the same time, we must ensure the right to hold and to express opinion is done so strictly within the confines of the ambit of the law. Now, Amendments 53 and 55 introduce a qualification to the duty on post-16 education bodies in comparison to what Section 19(2) of the Bill proposes. Now, further to the evidence presented to the committee at Stage 1, I'm aware that this should satisfy some of those concerned that the impact of Section 19 is introduced, but perhaps not all. Now, some have asked that for rights around academic freedom to be extended to the student population. Now, I think this would be practically difficult to achieve, and given that the nature of the relationship between governing bodies and students is quite different to that between an institution and its staff, I don't think that's a sensible option. Moreover, students, as any other person does, have the right to freedom of expression under current human rights legislation. With those thoughts in mind, therefore, I consider that Amendments 53 and 55 to be a proportionate response to these issues. They do provide balance, and I would encourage members to support both my Amendments 53 and 55. No other member has indicated they wish to contribute, therefore, can I call the Cabinet Secretary?
Thanks, Convener. It's worth noting that there is an existing statutory definition of academic freedom in legislation from 2005, and it is fair to say that the government took the opportunity presented with this bill to look to strengthen that definition. However, the bill as introduced strengthens the definition in, you know, a modest way, and we've certainly discussed issues in and around academic freedom as set out in the bill and the workshops that I alluded to earlier with a range of stakeholders. With regard to Amendment 56, I am sympathetic to what the member is trying to achieve, but I'd like to be crystal clear on one point, and that's that academic freedom enjoyed by those teaching and researching in our universities must be exercised within the law, and it does not, so to speak, represent a free pass to break the law. I am also very aware of the points raised by the Scottish Council for Jewish Communities in their evidence offered on the bill. However, I think that there may well be legal difficulties in applying an additional and subjective test based on any malicious intent in exercising academic freedom, in addition to an explicit requirement to comply with the law when exercising academic freedom. Amendments 51, 52 and 54 alter the wording in section 19 in a way that I consider weakens the original intention of the government to, as I said, strengthen academic freedom, and they simply reinstate the provisions which currently exist in sections 26(1) of the Further and Higher Education Scotland Act 2005. On Amendment 57, I appreciate the intention behind this amendment. However, given the often subjective nature of opinions held or expressed, I just don't think it's realistic to expect academics to produce hard facts to support any view or opinion they may hold or express. So for the reasons given already, I cannot support Amendments 51, 52, 54, 56 and 57, and I would ask committee to reject all amendments put forward by Liz Smith. Amendments 53 and 55, in the name of Stuart Maxwell, make a minor adjustment to the duty on all post-16 education bodies to uphold the academic freedom of its staff engaged in teaching and research, and to ensure that appointments and privileges of those persons engaged in teaching and research are not adversely affected by the exercise of their academic freedom. And I am content to support Amendments 53 and 55 so as to adjust this duty to qualify it so that in fulfilling the duty, a post-16 education body acts in a way that it considers to be reasonable. To be clear, though, this does not affect the requirement on those engaged in teaching and research to exercise their academic freedom within the law. I therefore support Amendments 53 and 55 and urge members to support these, but to reject the other amendments in this group if they are pressed.
Thank you very much. Cabinet Secretary, can I call Liz Smith to wind up and to indicate whether she wishes to press or withdraw her amendment?
The Cabinet Secretary made the comment that obviously there is already a definition of academic freedom. There is absolutely a definition of academic freedom. What I don't understand is why we are trying to amend that definition. The points that have been raised quite rightly by the convener himself about understanding that there has to be a balance with responsibility. I entirely accept that. For that reason, I'll be supporting his two amendments. But these are backed by many, in fact, I think the convener gave an example himself of human rights, etc. These are backed by law. What I think we've got into the territory of is trying to legislate on academic freedom that relates to some of the academic issues in institutions. And I come back to the point again that you find it impossible, and I noticed the Cabinet Secretary couldn't give me a list of any examples whereby institutions currently cannot do certain things within their subject areas, providing that is, as I say, not breaking the law. I just don't see where we're going with this, hence the reason why I lodged these amendments. And I have to say, I think it's one of the sections, in fact, you could argue all these sections of this bill are unnecessary. I don't think we should have been changing university governance in the first instance, but this, again, is one that doesn't really have any logical basis to it. So I will be lodging Amendment 51.
Thank you very much. The question is that Amendment 51 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed, therefore there's a division on Amendment 51. With all those who wish to support Amendment 51, please vote now. Those against? Abstentions? The result of the division on Amendment 51, there were 2 votes in favour and 7 votes against, therefore Amendment 51 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 52 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 51? Liz Smith, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 52 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not all agreed, therefore there will be a division on Amendment 52. Would all those members who wish to support Amendment 52 please vote now? Thank you. Those against? Thank you. The result of the division on Amendment 52, there were 2 votes in favour, 7 votes against. Amendment 52 is therefore not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 53 in my own name? I was already debated with Amendment 51, so I'm going to move Amendment 53. The question is that Amendment 53 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That's agreed. Can I call Amendment 54 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 51. Liz Smith, to move or not move?
Moved.
That's moved. The question is that Amendment 54 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not all agreed. Therefore, Amendment 54, there will be a division. Those who wish to support Amendment 54, please vote now. Thank you. Those against? Okay. Result of the division on Amendment 54, there were 2 votes in favour and 7 against. Therefore, Amendment 54 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 55, again in my own name, already debated with Amendment 51, and I'm going to move Amendment 55. The question, therefore, is that Amendment 55 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That's agreed to. Can I call Amendment 56 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 51. Liz Smith, to move or not move?
Moved.
That's moved. Therefore, the question is that Amendment 56 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not all agreed. There'll be a division. Would all those who wish to support Amendment 56 please vote now? Those against? Thanks. The result of the division on Amendment 56, there were 2 votes in favour and 7 votes against. Therefore, Amendment 56 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 57 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 51. Liz Smith, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 57 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not all agreed, therefore there will be division. Would those members who wish to support Amendment 57 please vote now? Thank you. Those against? Thank you. Abstentions? The result of the vote on Amendment 57, there were 2 votes in favour and 7 votes against, therefore Amendment 57 is not agreed to. The question is that Section 19 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Can I call Amendment 67 in the name of Chick Brodie in a group on its own? Chick Brodie, to move and speak to Amendment 67.
Thank you, Convener. I'll be very brief. The purpose of this, it goes back to what I said at a previous meeting in terms of, you know, when legislation is passed, we do 2 things. One is, invariably, we set targets which mean absolutely nothing, because they're only applicable at the time that they're applied. And my concern is that we, you know, those who don't agree with some of the provisions force the government into a situation of saying, well, we'll set certain targets, which I think is a nonsense. In fact, it doesn't just apply to this bill, if I may so say so on a personal level. It doesn't make sense, for example, in another area to have a target for a month, and then if you miss it, then split it up into 4. So instead of getting battered around the head the first for once a month, you get battered around the head 4 times a month. It just does not make sense. And I think one of the things to bed down this, and I'm sorry that the Code of Governance hasn't run its whole course, but one of the purpose behind this amendment is to suggest that all parties who are involved, whether we agree with all the provisions of the bill or not, allow a period of time that the Scottish Parliament decides that the bill should be scrutinised, but after a reasonable period of time wherein the bill is allowed to bed down and that we can actually see whether or not there's an improved outcome or not. Now, there is a suggestion that this perhaps is not the bill to introduce this. I would argue the converse of that, because I think it is... No question, we've all had it through our emails. It being contentious. That will not stop, in my opinion. And as a consequence, I think it behoves us to ask all parties to recognise that we should allow the bill, if passed, to bed down and after a suitable period of time look at the whether or not the objectives have been achieved and the outcomes in terms of the improvement of the performance of the higher education institution has in fact improved.
Thank you. Can I call Liz Smith?
I wholeheartedly agree with the comments from Chick Brody. I think post-legislative scrutiny will be required. This has been a bad bill. It's been a bad bill because it's been badly drafted. It's been a bad bill because there hasn't been relevant consultation and because of the fact that some of the drafting, and I'll come back to the Cabinet Secretary's comments earlier this morning about semantics. Semantics have been very important and unfortunately they've not been adhered to in the way that we have been able to interpret this. So I think there is a case. I still maintain that there is very little that is wrong with our university sector and I think a post-legislative scrutiny would be essential. So I'll support, or Mary Scanlon will support, Chip Brodie's amendment.
I think that's up to Mary Scanlon, but we hear what you say. Any other members wish to make a contribution at this stage? If not, I'll make a short one myself. I won't be supporting Amendment 67, not because I disagree with the principle of post-legislative scrutiny. That's obviously an important role for committees in this Parliament to make. I think there is a wider question about the ability of committees to have the time to actually undertake such activities, given the amount of work they currently do. But that's a wider question for the Parliament rather than a specific one for this particular bill. And I am slightly uncomfortable with the idea that committees will be instructed to carry out post-legislative scrutiny. I think it's a matter for committees. I don't support the idea of binding the hand of future committees. I think it's their decision to take, if they think it's the right thing to do at the time, to carry out post-legislative scrutiny. So on that basis, while accepting the principle and the fact that there is a question over post-legislative scrutiny, I don't think we should support this particular amendment and effectively, what I believe would be an uncomfortable situation, bind the hand of future committees. It should be a matter of the committees of this Parliament to decide for themselves whether or not they wish to undertake post-legislative scrutiny at the appropriate time, and therefore that's why I will not be supporting this amendment. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener. I want to thank Mr Brodie for explaining the intent of Amendment 67. I'm, of course, supportive of this committee and indeed any committee's right to scrutinise any legislation or provide that scrutiny role in any manner in which they see fit on any subject. The Scottish Government does not support this particular amendment, partly because Parliament is already enfranchised in the manner that Mr Brodie is seeking to achieve. And I'm sure the committee will agree that the current powers of the committee are adequate to examine the impact of this or indeed any other piece of legislation at any point in the future. Therefore, Amendment 67, in my view, is unnecessary. The Parliament does not need a statutory provision to give it permission to tell itself or its committees to carry out post-legislative scrutiny. The Parliament's committees are perfectly capable of looking into all matters within their...
I just wonder, many of the bills that have been passed in this Parliament have been fairly consensual, and I think most of us would agree that we could see the purpose and the reason for the bill. Other bills, the ministers of Labour, Lib Dems or SNP have accepted a sunset clause because there is a convention that legislation needs to be revisited after a period of time to see whether or not it is working. In the case of this bill, it has been highly adversarial. I don't think there's a university in Scotland that's in favour of it. So do you not think that, if you don't consider post-legislative scrutiny for an adversarial bill, is it not along the lines of a sunset clause that this bill should be revisited, given the height of criticism against it?
Well, with respect, Mrs Scanlon, I don't think it's unusual for bills brought before this Parliament to be debated in great detail or indeed, for there to be a level of you know, a high level of debate and difference of opinion. I mean, what I'm speaking to today is the amendment as proposed by Mr. Brodie, and that's Amendment 67. It's not actually my role as a minister to be telling any committee or indeed Parliament how to perform their role and function is scrutiny. And as I've already outlined in response to Mr. Brodie, Parliament is already enfranchised in this manner to do as it pleases. And I think the important thing here is to include such a provision could actually set an undesirable precedent that implied such a provision was necessary before the Parliament or indeed its committees carried out its daily parliamentary business, as I think the convener intimated. And I wouldn't want to set that precedent or make that implication. However, it may be of some reassurance to committee members that there will be, as discussed in previous stages of this bill, a role for the University Sector Advisory Forum, you know, to you know, assess the implementation and effectiveness of this bill. But that, of course, is secondary to the role of any committee in this Parliament and indeed Parliament as a whole to undertake their duties to scrutinise as and when and how they see fit.
Thank you very much. Can I call Chick Brodie to wind up and to indicate whether he wishes to press or withdraw his
amendment? Yes, thank you. Briefly, if I may, and I have lots of what the Cabinet Secretary said in terms of the forum looking at this. But at the end of the day, this bill will be passed. I don't see it as adversarial, but I certainly see it as contentious. It will be passed by the Parliament. I have a general view about bills of this nature that, as I said, should be bedded down and given the opportunity to run some of its course. With regard, convener, to your point about timetables, I have to suggest that because of the contentious nature of this bill, they will probably spend a lot of time trying to justify or not justify comments that will be raised because of the contentious nature of the bill. And what I'm trying to do is to assuage all that by saying we're going to have this scrutiny at a time to be determined by the Scottish Parliament, and that it will designate. I mean, it's up to the committees, it's right to say, although, you know, we have petitions that will refer to committees through the public forum. But what we have to do, I think, is to cool the jets on this now, if it goes through, and allow a period of time for all parties associated with this to secure the improved outcomes. And I would encourage the government, certainly in this bill and maybe in other bills, but certainly in this bill, to accept the amendment.
Pressing your amendment?
I'm pressing the amendment.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 67 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed, therefore there will be a division. Would all those who wish to support Amendment 67 please vote now? Thank you. Those against? The result of the division on Amendment 67, there were 3 votes in favour and 6 votes against, therefore Amendment 67 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 68 in the name of Liam MacArthur, group with Amendment 69, Tavish Scott, to move Amendment 69 and speak to both amendments in the group.
I apologise to Chick Brodie for not catching your eye, convener, during that last debate, because the only thing I'd add to that is that when the government introduced stage 2 amendments, which fundamentally change the bill, which have not been consulted on, as we have illustrated this morning, then I think Mr. Brodie's observations about post-legislative scrutiny were entirely appropriate and correct. Dare I say it, I have a heck of a lot of sympathy for the Cabinet Secretary on this one. I've been given the same speaking note as a former minister saying, don't, for goodness sake, let that one go. But I must say that all my reflections in the same time that Mary Scanlon and I have spent in this place is we don't do post-legislative scrutiny very well. And Chick Brodie tried to do Parliament a favour there by introducing it on a measure which, I take his point, may not be adversarial, but it's certainly highly controversial. So I hope Parliament, in the context of the conveners, might all reflect on that for the future, given you are one of those learned conveners, convener. Can I very briefly speak to Mr. MacArthur's very learned amendment here, which I nearly understand, which is an attempt to address potential concerns of the charity regulator in relation to the way in which ministerial powers under subordinate legislation might be used. Initial misgivings about the impact of the provisions in this bill might have on charitable status of universities were allayed, as I understand, by Oscar, when the focus turned to the more substantive and justified concerns about the real threat of ONS reclassification, and the Minister's taken actions there, which are obviously welcome and good. Nevertheless, as things now stand, Ministers will still have significant powers to amend this bill through secondary legislation, and I suggest that that needs to be constrained. Amendments 68 and 69 in Mr. MacArthur's name would achieve that, and I'd ask the committee to consider those and support them. Thank you.
Thank you very much. No other members indicated they wish to contribute, so can I call the Cabinet Secretary?
Convener, as a committee that regularly deals with primary legislation, you will know that this bill, as with any other bill, when it becomes a new law, could give rise to a need for a range of ancillary provisions. And Section 21 of the bill, as introduced, allows Scottish ministers to make ancillary provision without further primary legislation if a need is identified or a change is considered necessary or expedient. It is necessary, proportionate, and indeed commonplace in bills to allow for this flexibility. Indeed, committee members will recall the recent consideration of the Education Scotland Bill passed by Parliament on the 2nd of February, and that bill also contained a very similar ancillary provision. The power in Section 21 is limited to the extent that it can only be exercised if it is considered necessary or expedient for the purposes of or in connection with provision made by the Bill. Therefore, any such regulation must be closely and directly linked to the substance of the Bill. It is not a power which would allow ministers to make sweeping changes which run contrary to the underlying principles or express provisions of the bill. It is merely a quick fix for technical problems and is most certainly not a free hand. Further, if ministers were to make regulations under Section 21 which amend primary legislation, those regulations would be subject to affirmative procedure and therefore subject to parliamentary approval. I'm sure committee members will agree that this allows for adequate parliamentary scrutiny of anything that may be done under the power. So I therefore ask the committee to reject Amendments 60 and 69 in Liam MacArthur's name if pressed by Mr Scott.
Thank you. Can I call Tavi Scott to wind up and indicate whether he wishes to press or withdraw his amendment?
Thank you, Convener. I mean, I take the Cabinet Secretary's arguments. There is always merit in that approach, but in circumstances where a piece of legislation has been brought forward with the range of late amendments to it, then I would argue, and indeed Oscar have made this observation, not in this context but in a different context, that there is some merit, indeed great merit, in restricting the role of ministers to do exactly as a future minister may wish to do in this bill. It also rather makes a case for Mr Brodie's post-legislative scrutiny amendment, were that to have been successful here this morning, or this afternoon rather, because the illustration of the Minister's argument did not include, of course, any examples of what might be necessary. I would have hoped that any government would only embark on that route into yet further legislation, primary or secondary or otherwise, were a committee of this Parliament actually to have come up, reviewed the bill and to have suggested where there were mistakes. But we shall see on that one as well. I beg to move the amendment.
Mr. Scott, the question, therefore, is that Amendment 68 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed, therefore, there's a division. Would those who wish to support Amendment 68 please vote now. Thank you. Those against? The result of the division on Amendment 68, there were 2 votes in favour and 7 votes against. Therefore, Amendment 68 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 69 in the name of Liam MacArthur, already debated Amendment 68, Tavi Scott, to move or not move? The question is that Amendment 69 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not all agreed, therefore there'll be a division. Would those members who wish to support Amendment 69 please vote now? Thank you. Those against? Thank you. the result of the division on Amendment 69. There were 2 votes in favour and 7 votes against. Amendment 69 is not agreed to. The question is that Section 20 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? That's agreed. The question is that Section 21 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Can I call Amendment 24 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary? Already debated with Amendment 3. Cabinet Secretary, to move formally. Moved. The question is that Amendment 24 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That's agreed. Can I call Amendment 58 in the name of Liz Smith? Already debated with Amendment 19. Liz Smith, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 58 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not all agreed, therefore there's a division. Those who wish to support Amendment 58, please vote now. Those against? Abstentions? The result of the division on Amendment 58, there were 2 votes in favour, 5 votes against and 2 abstentions. Amendment 58 is not agreed to. Can I call Amendment 25 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 3. Cabinet Secretary, to move formally.
Formally move.
The question is that Amendment 25 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? That's agreed. Can I call Amendment 26 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 3. Cabinet Secretary, to move formally.
Yes.
The question is that Amendment 26 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That's agreed. The question is that the schedule be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
It's agreed. The question is that Sections 22 and 23 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That's agreed. The question is that the long title be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That's agreed. That ends stage two consideration of the bill, and I will very briefly suspend to allow the Cabinet Secretary and officials to leave. The next item is to consider 2 pieces of subordinate legislation as listed on the agenda. Do members have any comments on the instruments? Mary.
Not so much comment, but I had spoken to a couple of local authorities who actually raised the issue that they were concerned about the named person not applying to home educated children, and to be fair, they were both pleased to see that it was included. It's in 7. On page 3, the second paragraph, and both local authorities who'd raised this with me before, I notified them that it was happening, and they were pleased to hear that. But I just wonder, Convener, if there's any further information on the implementation of, you know, the named person, because many local authorities do have concerns about home-educated children, and really just to ask for a little bit of clarity. They weren't aware that this was coming forward, and if it was possible to look at how this will be implemented, I'd be very pleased to take it back to the local authorities that I spoke to.
Any other members of any comments at this stage? Colin?
Yeah, perhaps just on what Mary's
Sorry, guys, could you keep the conversation?
Just on what Mary's talking about there, it's maybe in connection with home-educated children. Actually, I have been speaking to the Minister about this because of a case I have in my constituency, and statutory guidance, which will come out later on, will actually deal with the gaps and so on in that service.
I think
very grateful to Colin Beattie for answering my question on behalf of the Minister. That's helpful. If
I wasn't
could just...
answering on behalf of the Minister, I was just explaining I'd been speaking to the Minister.
Well, you're closer to the source than I am, but I'm pleased to hear about that, and it would be helpful if we had some indication as to when that's coming forward and whether that will go through the committee or whatever.
There is one more piece of subordinate legislation on this still to come, Mary, so I'm presuming that's, I think we're talking about the same piece. Mm. So that will obviously come to the committee. I haven't got a date for that yet, but obviously quite soon, given we've only got a few weeks left.
Yeah.
If when that comes that you wish any further clarification on it, then I'm more than happy if you contact myself or the clerks immediately, and we'll ask the government if you contact us immediately, then we'll ask the government in advance of the committee day to try and get an answer for you just before the actual day of the...
But it is likely to happen before dissolution.
Yeah. Yes.
It is. That's very helpful. Thank you for that.
The indication is it will be the 1st of March.
Okay. That's very helpful. Thank you.
Okay. Well, with that, therefore, does the committee agree to make no recommendation to the Parliament on the instruments? That's agreed. Thank you very much for everybody's indulgence this morning. A long meeting, but with that, I close the meeting. Thank you.